NASCAR's greatest stars either got their start on this short track or scored major wins here that brought them into the national limelight. That includes two-time Daytona 500 winner Sterling Marlin, who returns to his home track today to face series champion Dale Earnhardt Jr., 18-year-old fourth-generation racer Adam Petty, and Casey Atwood, who last year at age 17 finished second in this race. It's the Nashville 320, and it's next. Fairgrounds and CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320, presented by Outback Steakhouse. Imagine if they played the Super Bowl in your local high school football stadium. That's what happens when the NASCAR cars of the super speedways of Daytona and Texas come to the short tracks. If you're used to 190-mile-an-hour racing on CBS, cinch up your seatbelt just a little bit tighter, because this is going to be action-packed. Let's go down to the front row of the starting grid, and Dick Berggren.
Thanks, Mike. Last year, Dale Earnhardt Jr. won 7 times on the way to this division's championship. He has yet to win this year, but he's got his best shot at a victory in 1999 today, starting on the pole. But this is one tough racetrack, and nobody knows that better than Earnhardt. He's been crashed here. He's been on fire here. Tough enough to finish. How do you win here?
Yeah, it is a tough place, but that's about time we got around to some short tracks, because we really enjoy that. But I just want to, you know, wish everybody good luck. We got a good car today, I think. AC Delco Chevrolet Monte Carlo is running good. I want to say hey to my dad. He's in, I believe he's on the boat. You know, I wish I was with him instead of him being here. I wish I was there. So, other than that, we're looking forward to a good day and a safe day for everybody, and hopefully we'll come out on top.
Good luck to you today, Dale. Terrell Shaheen.
Well, if you're a fan of Sterling Marlin today, you better be a fan of orange. You see, Sterling is a huge, and I do mean huge, fan of the University of Tennessee Volunteers. When they won the national championship in football this year, Sterling decided to honor them by painting his car for the 3 races in Tennessee. Looks pretty good, Sterling. You know, you're a track champion here in your beginnings. How do you have to win this place? What do you got to do?
Well, it's a little tough today. I tell you, it's a lot of competition in the Busch Series, and we've got a real good car, and just be patient. Track's going to be real slick, and hopefully hang on to it today.
Mike, no word if they're going to pump Rocky Top into his head just before the start of the race, or whether or not Old Smokey, the mascot, is going to show up in the pits.
It should be fun for Sterling today, returning to his racing roots. Hi, everyone, and welcome to Nashville. This is going to be unlike any race you've ever seen on CBS Sports when NASCAR's Best of the Busch Series come back to the short tracks. This is, instead of the give and take of super speedway racing, this is more like gouge and take. And it's likely that at the end of 320 laps, the only car that's not pretty well dented up will be the pace car. And Ned Jarrett, for race fans, that makes it a fun day.
It does make it a fun day for the drivers, really, and the fans as well. This is their first short track race of the year, first track they've run on that's under a mile in length. They do a lot of beating and banging on this kind of a racetrack. Most of these drivers grew up, got their early experience on this type of a track, so they like it. But, you know, beating and banging is normal on this kind of a racetrack, and I guess you can say it's sort of normal too that the tempers will flare.
Yes, they will, and one reason for that is how narrow this track becomes, Buddy Baker, coming up off the corner.
Mike, I used to race here. Turn two was always a problem. I always had problems getting out there. It's very slick. Yesterday in qualifying, Chris Cook coming off the corner. Watch the back go around into the outside wall. A lot of smoke. You can see how narrow the racetrack is over there. To illustrate this, I took a car out this morning, parked a car on the back straightaway. Imagine coming off this corner with a car on each side 100 miles an hour faster trying to avoid that car.
Well, that is a recipe for a wreck, to be sure.
You bet.
It's going to be a fun day, so get ready for some spine-tingling action here at the Nashville Speedway. Let's go trackside for the command.
Race fans, for those most famous words in motorsports, Faye Haynes.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
We'll be back with the starting lineup and the wave of the green flag after this.
CBS CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 is sponsored by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right. Nextel, you've never used a phone like this before. And by Scott's Lawn Products for a great lawn.
Joseph.
Yes, Papa.
There is an enemy that threatens all weeds. It is the spray.
So, we'll bribe it.
The spray does not respond to bribes.
What's the world coming to?
Roundup. No root, no weed, no problem.
That's me, Bill.
Here we are at the Super 8.
For reservations, call 1-800-800-8000.
We're talking rugged. We're talking fun. You ride the best and the job gets done. Polaris ATVs are made in the USA. We're talking tough.
Buy a new Polaris ATV now, and we'll give you a 2,000-pound worn winch kit. Or choose $250 toward other Polaris accessories. See your Polaris dealer for details.
Polaris ATVs, we're talking tough.
Join CBS as NASCAR rocks with the Allman Brothers and today's hottest performers for a kickin' coast-to-coast tour. A summer smash with NASCAR rocks.
Welcome to Nashville as the field is assembled, fired, and ready to roll here for 320 laps in the first short track race of the Busch Grand National season. Today, it is warm and a bit muggy here in Nashville. Under partly cloudy skies, there is the threat of rain in the forecast later today. But right now, a high ceiling and plenty of decent weather to go racing and get this one through. Let's have a look at the starting lineup for today's race. It's the fourth career pole for Dale Earnhardt Jr., the 98 series champ, and Sterling Marlin on the front row as well as he returns to his home track. Kevin LePage and Matt Kenseth, the Darlington winner. Phil Parsons, third here in 96, and Dave Blaney, runner-up in Atlanta. 92 series champ Joe Nemechek and 18-year-old Adam Petty. Dick Trickle, senior member of the field at 57, and Joe Buford, last year's Nashville Speedway track champ. Todd Bodine, fifth at Atlanta, and Stanton Barrett. Row seven, defending race champion Mike McLaughlin and Tim Fedewa. Jeff Purvis and R.D. Smith, a 19-year-old, making his Busch debut. Tony Roper from the Truck Series and Jeff Green, who was second at Daytona. Former ASA champ Tony Raines is back, and Randy LaJoy, the Daytona winner. Jimmy Kitchens with Alabama legend Rhett Farmer in his corner, and Hermie Sadler. Jason Jarrett makes his 20th Busch Series start, and Brad Loney from Iowa. Runner-up at Darlington, Elton Sawyer, and second here last year at 8:17, Casey Atwood. Buckshot Jones in for injured Larry Pearson, and Jason Keller, who was sixth at Texas last week. 1990 champ Chuck Bound, and Mike Dillon makes his fourth start at Nashville. Elliott Sadler for the injured Andy Santerre, and former track champ here, Andy Kirby. Ed Barrier and Jeff Fuller, the former modified champion. Kenny Wallace makes the field, and 20-year-old Kevin Grubb, who was eighth at Daytona. Barry Bodine, age 21, makes his third career start, and 18-year-old Justin Labonte debuts in the Busch Series today. Mark Green was 10th in Atlanta. Bobby Hillen, former Talladega winner. Then Glenn Allen with a crew chief change this week, and Hank Parker Jr. out of the All-Pro Series. Finally, Jeff Krogh, the 27-year-old from Idaho. That completes the 43-car field.
And Mike, there was a big field of cars that showed up here. 11 drivers had to go home, couldn't get in the field, including some drivers, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Mark Day, and Chad Chapman, who all run regular here at the Nashville Speedway.
Going to ride along with five drivers today here in Nashville. Sterling Marlin at Tennessee Volunteers race camp from the outside pole. Joe Nemechek, Bellsouth Mobility camp, will also have telemetry on board Joe's car, starting seventh. Stanton Barrett, our channel lock camera, Galaxy Motorsports number 40. And Mike McLaughlin, last year's winner of this race, starting 13th, the Gould's Pumps onboard camera. And Tony Raines picks up the Central Tractors Farm and Country Cam in the Bill Bumgarner Chevrolet number 74.
This is a 0.596-mile oval, banking 18 degrees in the corners and 3 degrees on the straightaways. They run upwards of 130 miles an hour on the straightaways here.
In the field today, there'll be 35 Chevrolets, 4 Ford, and 4 Pontiacs.
Green flag, we're underway for 320 laps at Nashville. Junior will lead the first lap from Sterling Marlin.
Sterling Marlin right on the bottom of the racetrack making a move as they start off turn two. You can see he got on the flat part of the racetrack.
Had one car in trouble here on turn two.
R.D. Smith, the 19-year-old rookie, making his first ever Busch Series start. He's been racing late models for 3 years at tracks like Ace Speedway, running in the Carolinas. And unfortunately, his debut may have come to a halt at one lap.
Yeah, that's a lot of damage to the right front corner there. I'm sure the suspension is knocked back about 3 or 4 inches there. He's in big trouble. I'd say he's over with for the day.
Well, folks, we told you they get around this track in a hurry, and there is action right from the start.
As Buddy said, a lot of damage to the right front suspension.
Yeah, you can see the wheel's not even turning. It's locked back against the firewall there.
There were a lot of cars that were running side by side still back in the pack as they were trying to sort themselves out. Normally, early in the race on a track like this, they want to get in single file as early as possible, try to get down on the inside of the racetrack, but they had not gone that far yet that everybody could get down there.
So Smith's car is on pit road. Let's show you what happened to him. Look way up on the right side of your screen in turn two. There he goes.
I think he just got a little too high, Mike, and maybe got up in what they call the gray stuff and a little bit of loose grit and gravel up there. Car got loose from him and got out from under.
Ned, it looked like he maybe turned a little bit, got sideways, tried to correct, and then maybe touched the brake just a little bit and it shot him straight up.
So that crew will have a lot of work to do to get him back into this race. 43 cars start the race today on a track that is just 0.6 of a mile around. Dick Berggren.
Well, this young R.D. Smith, Mike, is a really interesting story. In addition to being a race car driver, he's also studying business at a local community college. Limited racing experience. His father owns the car. He had never even seen this place until yesterday. Qualified solidly in the field, but many of the veterans went home. He got a lot of attention. People are looking at him, even though he's crashed early on. He's made a positive impression on this series.
He'd like to run 5 races this year and hope to pick up backing to run for Rookie of the Year in the year 2000.
This is a car they bought from the Diamond Ridge Motorsports team that Elliott Sadler drove for last year.
And let's show you the view from Tony Raines.
He's already high on the racetrack and had already gotten in trouble.
That's exactly what he did, though. It turned sideways. He cranked it back towards the slide and touched the brake because he realized he was in big trouble and shot him right straight up into the wall.
The King's here. Richard Petty watching his grandson, Adam.
Boy, I tell you, he thinks a lot of Adam. And every time Adam gets on the racetrack, Richard Petty's there if he can possibly get here.
Adam is in 7th position at the moment.
And they're going to push the Smith car behind the wall to attempt further repairs. First caution of the day out here. We've completed 4 laps. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is the leader. Now there's Sterling Marlin. This car now is not sponsored by the University of Tennessee. Folks, your college donations are not going into Sterling's race car. Actually, it's just the other way around. Sterling, as Ralph told you at the top of the show, he's a big fan of the Vols. So he has put all of their colors and logos on this car as a fundraiser. Souvenirs they sell from the racing effort will benefit the University of Tennessee, both academic and athletic scholarship programs. Pretty neat deal.
Look at the different lines these cars are running right now. You can see down, some people choose to run right on the bottom of the racetrack, some running a little bit higher in the corner. Everybody realizes this racetrack is extremely hard on tires.
One of those cars running high is, look at that third place car, number 99, Kevin LePage. He's taking a much higher line than the two leaders or number 17, Matt Kenseth.
And as the race goes on, I think we'll see other cars making that high line. It is a little surprising that we would see one this early doing it, but it's working for LePage, I think.
A race for third place there, and also for first right now. Sterling Marlin looking all over the back of Earnhardt Jr.
Putting the pressure on. Dropping to the inside, but whoa, Earnhardt's got some motor.
He had the traction coming off of turn two and the motor to carry him on off of there. Now Marlin's going to look high. Now he's going to try to dip down low, and that's a characteristic here, but you can do that better in turns one and two than you can in three and four. That is, go in and apex the turn, slip up a little bit, and then try to dive back down low, and that's what Sterling's trying to do there right now, but he can't quite do it.
Yeah, but he got a good run. He found out that if he comes off a little higher off the corner over there, he gets a good run. You see him looking to the outside of Earnhardt down the straightaway here, gets a good run down the straightaway.
Sterling Marlin, number 14, is a former track champion. He has raced here since 1976. He's raced here for 24 years. The leader right in front of him is 24 years old. For fourth place, third place. Now there's Kevin LePage, 99. Joe Nemechek challenges on the inside.
Joe Nemechek, he's practiced most of the week in the high line. Right now using the lower line to go by Kevin LePage. He's going to have a hard time just behind him, Phil Parsons in the 10.
We'll remind you on our running order in the upper left of your screen, cars displayed with a green background next to the position are cars that have advanced a position in the last lap. Cars displayed with a red background after the position, like Kansas moved up a spot there to third. You'll find Kevin LePage there displayed in red. He lost that spot last time by. Let's go back to the battle for 20th position, back where Jason Keller's on the inside, and up the outside, here comes Stanton Barrett.
Well, there are a lot of cars battling for that position.
Buckshot Jones in the double zero there.
Riding with Barrett.
And car number five, Dick Trickle, is off the pace down to turn one.
57 years old. There he goes to the outside. The field going by him. Trouble for Trickle, the oldest driver in the field.
Look at the fight for the lead right now. Sterling Marlin takes the lead away from Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Track stays green as Trickle drops to the apron, and he'll come to pit road.
He worked and worked and worked on him and finally got the run that he needed, made the pass.
Ned, as you're talking about Sterling, Matt Kenseth in the third place car is really making a charge towards the front right now.
Let's go to Ralph Sheheen.
Mike, the word came above, so to speak, for Sterling Marlin. Group chief Tony Glover radioed in to Sterling just one lap before he passed Dale Earnhardt Jr. and said, okay, now this time when you catch him, pass him. And it literally took Sterling one lap to get around Earnhardt Jr. Once he did, Tony radioed back in and said, okay, now find your groove and run patient.
Thanks, Ralph. Seventh place as Kevin LePage has drifted back to seventh into the clutches of 93 Dave Blaney. The hood is up on Dick Trickle's car, and in the wall is Justin Labonte in the front straightaway.
No caution yet. He's going down into turn one. Right in front of the leaders.
He hit the opening there, a little place there where you can go across the racetrack. You can see the right front corner was broken off there. No steering whatsoever. It veered right into that opening there, hit the wall where you go out of the racetrack.
We're under caution for the second time today. And the beating and banging, victims have included that concrete wall down entering turn number one. Somehow, Justin Labonte coming up off turn four got into the wall, and Buddy said the steering broke, and when the wall ended, the car shot to the outside.
Yeah, and most people at home would say, why didn't he put the brakes on? Well, he didn't have any brakes. Once that right front corner was kinked around like that, the brakes were gone.
He has radioed to the crew that he is okay. So two of the under 20 drivers have already suffered misfortune, R.D. Smith and Justin Labonte. Randy LaJoy, who is way older than 20, joked that they had to run this race at noon because half the field's not allowed out after dark.
Life in the Outback isn't all fun and games. After all, sometimes we have to eat.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Uh-oh. I'm a junior VP, and all the junior VPs have one of these. So I'll just call my secretary, and then she'll... voicemail.
Truck number four is down.
Gotcha. I'm a mailroom guy, and all the mailroom guys get to see the phones that the senior VPs get.
Nextel's two-way radio feature makes ordinary cell phones seem ordinary.
What do you look for in grass seed? Quick results?
We seeded it with Scott's seed last fall. As soon as I planted it, boom, it just came in.
A really terrific lawn?
And it feels like crushed velvet under your feet. It's wonderful.
How about weeds? Bargain brands can contain thousands of weed seeds that can ruin your lawn forever.
You can spend a dollar or two less for a bag of seed.
But you don't want weeds in your grass seed.
Scott's Premium Grass Seed, 99 and 99 100% weed-free for a beautiful lawn guaranteed.
We're here at a NASCAR race to take a survey. First question, does anyone sell as many high-quality auto parts as Napa? That'd be a no. Does anyone sell more hard-to-find parts than Napa? No again. Does anyone have as many ASE-certified employees? Last question, would you like to get paid for this survey? Just checking. Napa, over 200,000 parts, and everyone's important.
Monday on The Late Show, country super trio Willie Nelson, Lyle Lovett, and Kris Kristofferson, plus Charles Grodin. Later this week, Drew Barrymore and boxer Lennox Lewis.
Welcome back to CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320, presented by Outback Steakhouse. Justin Labonte's car is being hauled off on the record. He is okay. Let's see what happened here.
You can see the back of the car getting out against the wall, and then it snapped the front back into the wall. At that time, it broke the steering on the car. He's just along for the ride, plus the brake lining there. You can see he cannot stop it as he goes down. Now watch this opening right here. As he gets that opening, the car turns into that outside wall.
And hard. It tears the car up then.
Here's a look from the speed shot at start finish. Wow. Doesn't take long for things to happen here.
Yeah, when you hit with the back of the car like that, it's going to snap the front right around into the wall.
Let's check with Ralph.
Mike, tire management is a key to winning races here at Nashville Speedway. In turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, the track is very, very rough. Over the years, the cars going over the surface have pulled away some of the surface and made very, very rough edges on the asphalt. Best way to describe it is like this. Imagine this chunk of cheese as the tire of your race car. The cheese grater is very much like the surface of the racetrack. You go running across the track and running across the track. Now, depending on how hard you run across the track, depends how much rubber you're gonna wear off. If you're nice and easy on your tires, it'll look like this side when you're done. If you're not easy on it, it'll look like that side when you're done running on that set of tires, and you go to the back. Dick Bergren.
Kevin LePage started third today, but he has visited pit road for an extended stop. The problem, and this is the reason he was running so high in that number 99 car, brakes. So they worked on the brakes and tried to get them squared away so he could get into the turns better. Dick Trickle, who has had an incredibly tough year with 2 failures to qualify, 3 failures to finish in 6 starts, has also visited pit road. They think he has lost a rocker arm. That basically will mean he is down 1 cylinder, running on 7. Everybody else has got 8. He's not going to go fast. And Ralph, your cheese grater story works great with Adam Petty. They're having problems getting into the turn. They've told him take it easy so he doesn't chew the right front tire off. Mike?
Well, so far, old age and treachery leads youth and enthusiasm. 41-year-old Sterling Marlin leads them back to the green flag. 24-year-old Dale Earnhardt Jr. right behind, and then Robbie Reiser. Or excuse me, Matt Kenseth driving for Robbie Reiser, and that's 17.
And just behind him, Joe Nemechek, his line around the racetrack, he's really taking care of his tires. I look for him to be a big factor in just a little while.
Bill Parsons sitting there running in the 5th position as we look out from Nemechek in car camera.
The good part of that picture is you look back, he come off the corner very, very straight. The one thing you want to do here is get good grip and your forward bite off the corner, not slide off the corner.
First dozen cars are single file. All the way back to the Mike McLaughlin-Tim Fedewa battle right there left of your screen.
Jeff Purvis in the 4 there on the outside of Mike McLaughlin, side by side off that corner. That second line is beginning to come in as you see Purvis there running the higher line and keeping up with McLaughlin.
That's 12th and 13th they're racing for.
And Randy LaJoy, number 1, driving for James Finch. LaJoy, who... He runs pretty hard, both in the car and in front of the microphone. He has a good time with some of these young drivers. They call him the old man. That's him in that red number 1 just ahead of Mike McLaughlin. And he hammers those young drivers right back. Here's Ralph.
Mike McLaughlin thought he had a tire running. During that last yellow, he pulled up alongside a teammate. on the other hand, is a little loose right now.
Number of drivers going to make changes on that first pit stop. The weather is somewhat different here than what they practiced with late yesterday afternoon. Jason Keller's come from 28th to 14th, and a local star, defending track champ Joe Buford, is up to 8th.
You can see Tim Fedewa looking over Jeff Green there as they started in the corner. This is a give-and-take racetrack at the early part of the race. If a guy gets under you, you don't want to challenge him, maybe get yourself into trouble.
From Joe Nemechek, looking back there at Phil Parsons, 4th and 5th place.
Right behind Phil, that multicolored car back there is Adam Petty. You can see it as he came through the corner.
Ed, we were talking to Richard Petty this morning. He said the one thing we have to do, we have to keep a bridle on him. He wants to go wide open all the time.
How about Casey Atwood in 27? This is not the car he ran to a second place finish with here last year, but now he's a full-timer on this circuit at age 18. Last year he was a high school student. This week he went back to school with his race car and race team to see all his old friends and kind of catch them up on what he's been doing. Said it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I said, did they put you on a pedestal? He said, no, I'm just one of the guys until I crawl into that car. Then I'm a hero.
He was signing a lot of autographs down there this morning. And right with him, Tony Raines, who's back after being hurt. Not a lot of single file running here. There's Dave Blaney in 93. Going down on Joe Buford, the defending track champ at Nashville. That's that 67.
That car has a good history there that Buford's driving. That is a Jack Roush car that won at Darlington with Jeff Burton driving it last year.
He's giving it a good ride. Won the late model race here last night to kick off the Nashville Speedway season.
There's the number 32 of Jeff Green. He's trying to work his way up through here. He has a lot of laps on this racetrack.
He's a track champion in 1990 here, as a matter of fact. So he knows how to get around. All the Greens know how to get around this track.
33 laps are complete. Sterling Marlin leading Dale Earnhardt Jr. The Nashville 320 continues on CBS Sports after this message and a word from your local station.
It knows two speeds. Stop and go. It just beat a series of the toughest stop and go driving tests in the world, and it's brand new. Go ahead. Guess. You have 4.3 seconds. Introducing Pennzoil with new Pure Base. Stop. Go. Pennzoil.
Figaro, 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 Figaro here. Hey, Figaro, Figaro there. Hey, Figaro, Figaro here, Figaro there. Figaro up, Figaro down, Figaro.
Figaro lawn fertilizer gives you more predictable, continuous feeding, whether it's hot, cold, wet, or dry. Figaro. People everywhere are singing its praises.
Figaro.
Only at the Home Depot.
This is what it's all about. This is what you play for. I've waited 18 years for this moment.
On the Masters!
A tradition unlike any other. The Masters on CBS.
The address is CBS.
Welcome home.
Attention! Please pardon this interruption, but we're presenting an offer from Nasonex. A coupon for a free one-month trial. For information and a coupon for a free one-month trial, call 1-800-680-4600. Talk to your doctor to find out whether Nasonex is right for you. The call and the offer are free, so call today. 1-800-680-4600.
CBS Sports and News Channel 7 take you live to America's premier golf tournament, the Masters. We'll set the scene from Augusta National with our Masters preview special Wednesday at 7:30. Plus, watch for live updates throughout the week on News Channel 7 at 5:30, 6, and 11. And a complete recap each night of the tournament following News Channel 7 at 11. The Masters on News Channel 7. Sports from where you live. Jack Roper and the Doppler 7 Storm Team. Weather from where you live.
Tonight on CBS, it's a wild night at the opera for martial arts superstar Sammo Hung. And it's not over till the Fat Cop sings Martial Law tonight on CBS. Here at Nashville Speedway, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has lost second place.
Yeah, and the amazing part, he's still down on the low side of the racetrack, and Kenseth just got tired of running behind him, moved to the outside, and you see Joe Nemechek, now Phil Parsons. The three is off just a little bit on the handling package right now.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr., of course, was very fast. He won the pole here. I talked to Tony Urey Sr., the manager of that team. He told me this morning, said, we had an awfully good qualifying car. I'm not so sure that it's a good race car. And there is a difference in the chassis of a car in qualifying and in the race.
Dick Berggren is in Earnhardt's pit.
And their concern here, Mike, is that Earnhardt can't get on the gas as soon as he wants or as hard as he wants. He says he has to feather it coming off the corner, or it just doesn't stick, and he continues to drop back. Meanwhile, the 87, Nemechek, he started in fourth spot. He's not delighted with his race car either. That particular car is loose. Tail end is trying to come around. The real problem here is, you're right, Mike Joy, the weather has changed from all the practice and qualifying, and the sun has affected the chassis setups on these cars. Many of the drivers are not happy with them. Karel Shaheen.
Matt Kenseth, driver for the number 17, is racing with a very heavy heart here this afternoon. A dear friend of his, Al Shill Jr., a competitor in NASCAR's RE/MAX series in the Midwest, passed away this week. Matt had to run off to attend the funeral and just arrived here at the racetrack just the other day with a very heavy heart. In honor of his friend, he's running stickers on the car in his memory. Mike?
Thanks, Ralph Kenseth. Currently posted in second behind Sterling Marlin, leading his first Busch Grand National race since this event back in 1996. He won at Charlotte in 1990 in NASCAR's Junior Series.
And he has about a 1.6 second lead on Kenseth. Of course, Kenseth lost some of that lead, or Sterling was able to build up his lead while Kenseth was racing with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
See Tim Fedewa there in the 36. Randy LaJoy, teammates with him last year. You see him racing very, very hard side by side down into turn three. Give it to Randy LaJoy, and just behind him, Jeff Purvis in the four car.
LaJoy coming hard, picks up the 12th position. And here comes up the outside, the four of Jeff Purvis. Purvis from Clarksville, Tennessee, but he never raced a whole lot on this racetrack.
Casey Atwood there in the 27, also doing a great job on the bottom side of the racetrack, trying to hang on to that car. But you're talking about Earnhardt a while ago. He dropped all the way to seventh spot already. He got to the outside. Adam Petty got by him. Phil Parsons, Joe Nemechek, and he's about a straightaway behind now.
Now here's Marlin coming up to lap 64. Barry Bodine, Jeff Bodine's son. Jeff is here and maybe spotting for his son today, making his third Grand National start.
Hard to lap him when they're running side by side. That's Jimmy Kitchens, who's in a backup car. Of course, they singled out there, and he was able to get by Kitchens.
And Kevin LePage has gone behind the wall. Dick is with him.
And he's pumping the brake pedal back here, Mike. He's lost the brakes. Kevin, what's it like to race here without brakes?
It's no fun when you got a car that qualified third and you got all 42 cars behind you waiting to try to crash you, but we only got rear brakes. And I hate it, you know, 2 weeks in a row we're here. We got problems early in the garage. Got a great race team, but we just need a little bit better maintenance, I guess.
Kevin LePage is going to step out of this car and let somebody else drive it for the next couple of races so he can concentrate on his Winston Cup career. Mike?
Not too many Winston Cup stars here, at least not in the car. Sterling Marlin leads the race. Of course, he is a Winston Cup regular, as is Kevin LePage. Back up front, Sterling Marlin. He has a number 14 on the back of his uniform today that is as big as that number on the side of the car. I mean, it looks like a football uniform, Ned, except for all the extra sponsors all over it.
A little bit different in racing than in your ball sports as far as the commercialism that is involved.
I bet when he retires the colors of this car, though, and they make the car that they're going to sell, the miniature car, I bet that suit will go on auction, and I bet it'll bring a big price for Tennessee fans. I would think.
Hope it will. Saw Adam Petty there. Adam moving in fifth position, and Todd Bodine closing in.
Adam Petty in the 45 there is flying around this racetrack. I would imagine King Richard right now saying, son, take it easy. You got a great car. He moves in on Phil Parsons there. Just behind him, Todd Bodine in the 66. These guys are moving towards the front.
Now, Richard told us this morning, he says, right now, Adam, he's young, he's enthusiastic, and he's learning some of the things he can't do. And yes, he's tearing up some cars, but as soon as he gets that out of the way and starts learning all the things he can do with that race car, he's going to be a good one.
He seems to have the genes and the talent.
We'll be right back to Nashville, 56 laps complete.
All right, come on out of there.
You're gonna have to do better than that, cop.
Okay, I figure that there are three of you versus 300 of us. As for the building, we have assembled officers here, here, and here, as well as sharpshooters here and here.
The sharpshooters. Where are they again?
Sometimes it's not just what you say, but how you say it. Kinko's. Express yourself.
For those smokers who are ready to quit, Nicorette introduces a breath of fresh air. New mint-flavored Nicorette gum. The same craving-fighting power of Nicorette and the flavor of mint. Nicorette helps you control your cravings so you can break free from smoking. And now you can choose your flavor. Now isn't that a breath of fresh air?
Nicorette helps you fight your cravings, your habit, your way. You can do it. Nicorette can help.
In the next 10 minutes, new journeys will begin. Small wonders will occur. And cooking up a great beef dinner will take you just, you guessed it, 10 minutes. How? With nutritious, fully cooked and prepared beef dishes. They're in your grocer's meat case. Just heat for 10 minutes and enjoy. In the next 10 minutes, good things are gonna happen.
I need the first meatball.
Beef. It's what's for dinner tonight.
Now 100% of the people can get on the internet. When you buy a Gateway Essential PC with a 400 megahertz Intel Celeron processor as low as $37 a month, we'll give you a year on the internet. Call, click, or come in. We know the internet is calling you.
Doug Flutie and Olympic gold medalist Tommy Moe lead the stars into battle as they run, bike, shoot, and swim their way to victory. The Snapple Superstars on CBS.
For non-stop auto racing coverage, news from the track and more, go to cbs.sportsline.com or on America Online, enter keyword CBS Sportsline. Here at Nashville, 63 of 320 laps complete. Leader Sterling Marlin took over the lead on lap 13 from pole sitter Dale Earnhardt Jr. and has led all the way since.
He has a 1.82 seconds lead now, Matt Kenseth.
Another one of the young stars behind the wall. Dick Bergman's with him.
Young Justin Labonte is the youngest man to start today's race. His day is all over. First Busch Series start ends in the wall. What happened?
I just think I lost it. You know, the radio tires jumped up and bit me. I was trying to get under somebody, and so we didn't get a lap down early, and kind of broke a little loose, and I tried to save it, and it just shot me right into the wall. But I learned my first lesson here in the Busch Series, and you got to really be careful on these tires.
His dad, two-time series champion Terry Labonte, is talking it over with Grandpa and Ma. They say this kid's a good one. He's going to come back and win some races.
Could well be the case, Dick. Justin Labonte having a tough day in his Busch Series debut. Sterling Marlin kind of alone on the racetrack there. About to get into a big pack of lap traffic. Let's go back in the field a ways, back to that double zero. A Buckshot Jones in for Larry Pearson today. He is 16th in that pack.
Yeah, we want to say to Larry Pearson, we're looking forward to when he gets back in that car again. Severely pulled the muscles in his back in a wreck in Texas.
Jones started 27th. He's up to 16th. You're watching from Mike McLaughlin, who is 17th. Back at Tony Raines, and Raines is just back behind the wheel after being injured a little earlier this season. Let's have a look at the gauges there on Tony Raines' car as he pulls down on Mike McLaughlin. And get an idea of the speeds and the RPMs they turn here at Nashville.
Now, these cars don't turn as many RPMs as the Winston Cup cars, although he's getting up there close to 8,000.
And about 125 miles down the straightaway, about 80 in the center of the corner.
About 85 in the center of the corner, 100. Look at it accelerate down the straightaway, about 125. You could see when it broke loose a little bit coming off the corner, went all the way over to 140. That wasn't real. That was tire spin.
There it is again coming off the corner, all the way to 8,000 RPM. Ralph?
Mike, Tony Raines said
10th place side by side there. Dale Earnhardt Jr. up high. Casey Atwood takes the spot away. This will be for 8th place.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. extremely loose. He's going back through the field right now. Casey Atwood got by him. You can see the back of the car of Earnhardt off the corner getting extremely loose.
Jason Keller's moved up to 10th from 28th. Casey Atwood from 26th to 9th today.
Mike, and when you see a car like Earnhardt's get sideways up out of the corner like that, it heats the tire in the next corner you go into. It only puts more heat in it, loses more grip, and the back of the car is actually trying to pass the front getting in the corner. You're real loose getting in.
You know, what's really impressive about 27 Atwood is this morning, Ned, they had the whole suspension pretty much apart on that car. Casey says we're changing a whole lot of things from yesterday's practice.
Yeah, they were not like they wanted to be in practice yesterday afternoon and decided they needed to make some changes. And one thing about it, they don't mind gambling, and most of the teams don't either. They say, hey, we're not good the way we are. Let's gamble and put something else under the table.
Whoa, two Ooh. Young bucks there. They're rubbing horns as they go through the center of the corner there. I'm telling you right now, Casey Atwood is driving a perfect race right around the bottom of the racetrack. When he picks the throttle up, very easy back, just like an egg under the accelerator, not to break those rear tires loose. And as you said, Mike, it was a guess on the chassis setup. They didn't know what they had, but they know they have a great driver.
Let's stay with this battle because there's lapped cars right in front of them, and that track that is too wide to race on now is going to get single file. And you see Adam Petty breeze the throttle into the corner so he can follow Casey Atwood through some of that lap traffic. Jeff Green, 32, trying to thread the needle on the low side as well. He's right up against Todd Bodine. They're going to get underneath Barry Bodine. That is Todd's nephew, who has gone a lap down.
Barry looks like he's real tight. That means his car won't turn getting in the corner. He can't keep a low line in the corner, so Casey Atwood should dispense with him pretty quickly.
And does.
A lot of these cars doing a lot of slipping and sliding right now. They've worn those tires down pretty good, and the track is getting a little slick.
For more on Adam Petty, here's Ralph.
Mike, Ned is exactly correct. Crew chiefs up and down pit lane have been radioing to their drivers, telling them everybody is starting to get loose. Make sure you're patient. Watch your tires. If the car behind you is pushing very hard, move over, let it by, tuck in behind him. That is exactly what they said to Adam Petty. He let Todd Bodine and Casey Atwood go by, and now he's starting to follow them. Dick?
Well, one of the smart things that Petty did is yesterday in happy hour, while many of the drivers went out on fresh tires, he went out on very old tires. The strategy, let's see what this car will do when the tires are worn and the driver is maybe a little bit tired. And that's about where we are right now. He won that happy hour session on old tires. But here we go again with the weather. It's changing again, Mike. We've got a little overcast, and that affects the way the car is handled.
You can see Casey Atwood, it was fighting Phil Parsons there. He took over 6th place there. They were going right in the corner. He's looking down on the bottom side as we speak. I'm really impressed with Casey Atwood. Every time I see him, I compared him to a young Fireball Roberts in Daytona this year. First time ever there, running 2nd place with a couple of laps to go. Got collected in an accident he had nothing to do with, but what a driver this kid is.
10 years ago, an 18-year-old would be just starting his racing career on one of the short tracks, and it would be 10 or a dozen years before he got a chance at a car like this. But Atwood is showing an awful lot of maturity. 83 laps are complete here at Nashville. Sterling Marlin leading Matt Kenseth.
Who'd you get the club?
Accounting.
Accounting gave you a club?
Yeah, I made him a deal.
Deal?
Whenever my cell bills are half as much as yours, they give me a club.
Aren't you on the phone all the time?
Yeah, but I have Nextel. My calls are rounded to the second. I pay less.
That's not fair. I want to be rounded to the second. I want clubs.
Where do I get my putter?
Giving you a putter?
Nextel's 1 second rounding makes ordinary cell phones seem ordinary.
Today we're going to learn the easy way to mow the lawn. This is a lawn. This is a boy. Lawn. Boy. Lawn. Boy. Lawn boy. Easy, huh?
Lawn boy. Easy to start, easy to use, easy to maintain.
Any questions?
Why are there two of you?
As NAPA drivers, you're responsible for safely delivering the best parts in the world. So I've brought in a special guest instructor, Ron Hornaday, NASCAR Truck Series champion.
Well, if you want to go to the turns, about 130.
What's a safe distance to be from the guy in front of you?
5 inches. It's called drafting.
Huh?
All right, get in the truck. I'm going to have to show you. You getting all this down?
They're going to can me for this.
Of Busch Beer, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
This CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by Smooth Busch Beer, an easy-drinking Busch Light. Busch, the official sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
After 86 laps, two leaders, pole-sitter Earnhardt Jr. and Sterling Marlin, just one lead change, two cautions for eight laps. And off the track, Kevin LePage, Justin Labonte, Dick Trickle, and the 19-year-old R.D. Smith. Big cheer from this crowd a moment ago, Casey Atwood. The 18-year-old, who ran regularly here for the last two seasons, has moved up from 26th starting position to second place.
That is an impressive run, although he's about 5.8 seconds behind leader Sterling Marlin, but he has come through a lot of traffic, passed a lot of race cars, and is moving on.
Ned, the impressive part of what he did, he went on the bottom of the racetrack to get by everybody. Look at his line now. He's moved back up a little higher on the racetrack, taking care of those tires for the next onslaught. When he catches, I think he'll catch Sterling sooner or later. I think the car is hooked up that well.
Well, he's cutting his speed or the distance down by about 0.2 seconds a lap. And that'll take a little while, but he is definitely gaining.
Casey Atwood on the move. Todd Bodine had taken second from Matt Kenseth, carried Atwood with him, and then Atwood passed Bodine for second place.
And the leader is in very, very heavy traffic. He's the orange car, number 14, Sterling Marlin. You see cars, there's Kenny Wallace in car number 25. Up there's the number 8 car, Bobby Hillen. Those cars racing hard for position. But there now are 26 cars on the lead lap. Sterling Marlin put a lot of them away, but boy, he's got it running into a tough bunch here.
Yeah, Kenny Wallace is a tremendous driver. Won several times on Busch Fendall National Division. Good car. But Sterling right now is hooked up. He's in another zone for most of the cars out there.
He's lap past Glenn Allen in the 38. Marlin has 51 feature victories on this racetrack. That is second to Darrell Waltrip on the all-time Nashville list. Bobby Hamilton is third on that list with 27. Ralph?
Mike, two big problems for Sterling Marlin right now. He's got a 7-second lead, which is great. The bad news is the 25 car just in front of him, the Kenny Wallace, is smoking really bad. And Sterling, greater than he's throwing oil all over his windshield. Crew chief Tony Glover's been going crazy with the NASCAR officials trying to get Kenny out of the way. The other problem
is that
there is a big piece of white paper stuck to the grill on the front of Sterling's car. They're keeping an eye on the temperature, but the Kenny Wallace problem is really getting Tony Glover.
Boy, big trouble there a second ago as Tim Fedewa got bounced in the back bumper, and the whole group here had to check up as they almost all piled into each other.
And you say, Ned, first thing, why don't these guys get out of the way? They're fighting like heck out there right now not to go a lap down. They don't want to go a lap down. They're racing each other for position. It's up to Sterling to find his way by.
Chuck Bowen had gotten lapped, but in that little melee over there, he got back on the lead lap. Now Kenny Wallace coming into the pits.
They'll have to address that smoking problem.
Yeah, just a while ago, you could see a little moisture coming out of his car back on the camera that we had with Sterling Marlin there. You could see the spots. I thought it might be a little bit of rain, but it wasn't.
A little bit of rubber chunks coming off this very abrasive racetrack. And that little bit of oil as well. Trying to lap past Chuck Bow. Goes our race leader, Marlin. Let's drop back and find the third place battle. 66, Todd Bodine chasing 32. Jeff Green Green had a great run going in Texas, but they lost about 8 or 10 horsepower. Thought they might have hurt the motor in the last practice. And he was still able to be a contender and a near victor last week.
As you see these cars, Matt Kenseth has dropped back a little bit now. I think he's really on a tire conserving run himself right now. He went up there, run pretty hard, got up to second. Now he's dropped it back just a little bit.
Sterling Marlin now working under Kenseth, or rather Tim Fedewa in the 36.
Well, he decided he backed off there a moment ago and said, let me just take these guys one at a time. They were running side by side up in front of him and used up a lot of racetrack.
Let's go back in the field a bit. Randy LaJoy, number one, running in 14, trying to get underneath Joe Nemechek, who was up near the front when we dropped the green flag here.
Tony Raines in the car number 74, right up there in that pack. Tony has made a good run from his 19th starting position.
Ride with Tony.
He's up to 15th now.
Randy LaJoy just ahead, Nemechek in front of him. These cars really waggle around out there, and that's just the car breaking loose of traction, either going into the corner or when the driver puts the pedal down to apply the power. You're driving a car, buddy, that technically is sliding out of control at that point.
Well, that's going to slide some. The biggest thing you have to do is what Tony Raines did there. He got a better angle off the corner, a lot of forward grip, and he just put LaJoy right away coming off the corner.
Randy LaJoy, to remind you two after last week, has been wearing his Yukon Huskies hat around the pits all weekend.
No, I've worn it quite a few times. Every time I was trying to interview somebody, he'd stick that hat on my head because he knows we're from North Carolina, and I said something about Duke last week, and I got to wear the Husky hat.
Yeah, the Huskies had something to say about it. That was a great game Monday night on CBS. What a wonderful game for the national championship.
It really was.
A lot of proud nutmeggers here today. All right, Todd Bodine has made it underneath Jeff Green. Trouble turn two. One car has been spun around. That's the number 90 of Brad Loney. Everybody else.
Caution is out as the car number 36 of Tim Fedewa comes down pit road. He had just been lapped.
Ned, he needs to go out and try not. Well, he's already been lapped now. He had to come down pit road, and it's hard not to get lapped.
Yeah, he had lost a lap on the racetrack. The leader had just passed him a few laps ago, and then now he might lose another one.
Well, I don't think he will, Ned, because Sterling Marlin was on the back straightaway as Fedewa came down the pit lane, and so he was allowed to scoot out in front of the pace car, which had to wait to pick up this man, Sterling Marlin.
Okay, boy, this will be a welcome break in the action here. A lot of drivers wanting to get into pits, get some new tires on those cars, get some adjustments made.
I think Peyton Manning ever wore a helmet like that.
Well, I tell you what,
I doubt it.
They were number one in football, and he's number one today as far as getting around this racetrack. You see him kind of resting his arms there, getting a little drink of water, that little tube there. That's how you get water in a race car. You stick it up under your helmet, right in your mouth, and drink.
So we are under caution. Let's show you why down the front straightaway. From Mike McLaughlin's car. Here's the 90. Oops.
Ooh, Dale Earnhardt Jr. ran up and thought he had an opening down on the inside that made contact, and around he went.
Another look at it here.
That's not going to change. He gets left for a corner of Loney there, turns him around, goes high. Now he says he's going to drift back up. See everybody checking up and trying to get to the bottom of the racetrack.
34 McLaughlin lost three positions because he was in the high groove, and that's where Loney slid up. So the caution is out once again. Here in Nashville, Sterling Marlin leading. What changes will they make on these pit stops?
For Dan and Lisa, it just clicked. So they loaded up their Ford Expedition and got back to doing what they loved, answering the call of the wild.
I lost them.
And they unleashed a beast of their own, that big 5.4-liter Triton V8.
You thought Little Red Riding Hood got a close look. Ford Expedition, built Ford tough.
My dad's just moved in with us. He's quite a character, very disciplined, very organized. And that's gonna be difficult with two very active little boys. I know his appearance is very important to him. He keeps those shirts of his spotless. I don't want them to end up dingy when they get thrown in the wash with the kids' dirty stuff.
Liquid Tide's new clean rinse formula. It helps prevent dirt in the wash water from redepositing on clothes, so everything comes out whiter than with regular detergents.
I think they're gonna learn a lot from each other.
Every 10 seconds or so, a stop sign goes up somewhere in America. and every 30 seconds a traffic light goes up. It's as hard on your car as it is on you. It's stop and go. Stop and go. Stop and go driving. Use Pennzoil. Formulated for today's stop and go driving. Stop. Go. Pennzoil.
So, Murray, did you hear?
About Nick across the way?
Yeah, got sprayed.
Didn't he just get sprayed?
Yeah, but didn't get the roots. Whatever got him this time was different.
I didn't think anything could take old Nick.
Hey, next time, it could be us.
Roundup. No root, no weed, no problem.
Little Caesar is turning 40, and to celebrate, we're giving away free pizza. Now buy two pizzas for $11.97, get a free dessert and a free pizza on your next visit.
Pizza, pizza.
An American stealth fighter goes down behind enemy lines. Guess whose job it is to get it back?
We are here to recover our plane.
JAG, CBS Tuesday.
Welcome back to the Nashville 320, presented by Outback Steakhouse. We are under caution for the spin up in turn number two. Pit stops have been completed. Monday on the King of Queens. Imagine you skip breakfast, don't have time for lunch, and then go to a party where the only thing to eat is plant food. Feed your appetite for comedy with the King of Queens Monday on CBS. What happened on pit stop, Dick Bergeron?
Well, what happened in Casey Atwood's pit stop, Mike, was anything but good. He came in second, went out 14th, a 27.4-second stop. Nothing went wrong except the fact that it was incredibly slow. The car is fine. They made a minor adjustment to try and tighten the chassis up a little bit, but the driver is overheating. He has had the flu for several weeks, and before he made his pit stop, he keyed the radio and said, "I need water bad," and he swallowed virtually a whole bottle of it. He's still really not feeling right. He'll feel better if the pit stops can improve.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. is back in for his second stop.
And his first one was a long one. He almost went a lap down.
You can see him pulling out on the sheet metal there on the right front corner. It was back against the tire there. They're working on the crush panels there right now, trying to beat the side of the car back in. A little bit of damage when he had contact there with Loney just a second ago.
So he'll be the last car on the lead lap, and there are 25 cars on the lead lap.
Ralph, what happened at the other end of pit road?
Mike, for Sterling Marlin, they took off a piece of tape off the front grill. They changed tires and put in fuel. They were allowed to put an extra man over the wall to clean the windshield. Remember, Kenny Wallace spilled the fluid all over it. They were also going to make an adjustment out of the right rear that came down 1 pound back there. With Todd Bodine, they raised the track bar 1/4 inch, took 4 tires and fuel. Matt Kenseth made an air pressure adjustment and took 1.5 turns of wedge out of the car. He had been pretty loose. They wanted to get him running right as well.
Looking out the windshield of Sterling Marlin, and just a bit of haze over on the right side, some of it off the Kenny Wallace car. But what they clean is from that bar to the left edge of the windshield, because that's where the driver's view is focused, unless he's headed the wrong way.
Exactly. The only time you look out the right side of a windshield is somebody's right on your right front corner, and you're going down in the corner.
So we'll go back to green with Marlin leading Jeff Green, who's also a native of Nashville Speedway, Todd Bodine, Matt Kenseth, Jason Keller, Adam Petty,
green flag.
Casey Atwood, Phil Parsons, Dave Blaney, Jeff Purvis, the top 10.
Well, as they say, it's an entirely new race now. Most of the teams have been in, made adjustments on their cars. Now we'll see who has the muscle after adjusting on the cars.
Marlin and Green got a good jump on the field and got away. They're 3 wide even back in the pack. Look at this battle is stuck in the middle.
Yeah, the 28 car, I don't know what the problem is with it, Mike, but he is slower and the car is trying to go inside, outside. They're 3 wide there.
Man, he's got a tremendous amount of body damage on that car. Somebody's gotten into him pretty hard there.
That's Andy Kirby, former track champion. And again, Mike McLaughlin has no luck. 5 cars went past him. For the lead, Jeff Green. Underneath Sterling Marlin.
Jeff Green, 1990 track champion right here. He and Sterling Marlin have mixed paint before, and they just did a little bit in turn 3 there.
Marlin dives it in hard on the outside. He doesn't want to give up this lead.
He thinks he can get a run off the turn, but so did Green down on the inside. Those new tires made him get traction down on the inside. And boy, he drives it deep in that corner.
And Todd Bodine's licking his chops there in third place in the 66 car. You can see he's run them down now and less than a car left back.
Todd told me this morning he's got as good a car as he had last week in Texas when engine failure shortened his run. Matt Kenseth right there with them in fourth. Jason Keller up to fifth, having the best ride he's had this season.
Jason was looking forward to short tracks. Of course, he ran a lot at Greenville Pickens Speedway in South Carolina. A track very similar to this, not quite as much banking as this track has, but he said, I just want to get to the short tracks. He said, I think I can show him something.
Jason Keller there soldiering along in fifth place in the 57 car. He's running very, very well today.
Dick Bergeron.
This morning, before anything really got going here, I asked Jeff Green, what is the key to being fast and winning races here at Nashville? He told me, be consistent, be easy. You cannot manhandle a race car here. I asked Joe Nemechek the same question. He said, Bergie, you just got to be around at the end at Nashville. Right now, Green is running a beautiful race as he leads today.
Boy, back in the pack here, they are going at it side by side. You see Dillon there in the 59 down the straightaway. Look at the different lines everybody's running right now. You can see a little fire coming out of the exhaust pipe. That's unspent fuel, no problem with the car. You'll see that in, oh, a little touch there. Fuller got touched there in the 89, just a little bit on the left rear corner.
New crew chief on that 59 car, Jeff Fuller up on the, tries to give a little room up on the outside for McLaughlin, who's got to be getting a little impatient here. He pulls right up on the back bumper of Dave Blaney, last week's pole sitter. Here comes Earnhardt Jr., number three, back into the race.
Yeah, a little damage on the right side, but it's all cosmetic. It's not anything to do with the chassis work on the car. Jump bound going right along with Earnhardt as we come off the corner. Blaney off just a little bit right now.
Let's get out of his pit round.
Senior is the man in charge of Dale Earnhardt Jr. You brought the car in a second time, Tony. How bad is it?
He stole the car on the jack line. It was on the right side. He was trying to start it. He drove off the jack. So we got the left front lug nuts off. We never took the left rear off. We tossed the car back to left. Took the left front off. Let him go around. Came back and changed the left rear. Went ahead and put a rubber in the left rear. The car spinning the tires real bad off the corner.
Tony Urie Sr., Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s crew chief. For the lead, Sterling Marlin is coming back after Jeff Green.
Exactly what he's doing. He did not abuse his tires. He did not fight with Jeff Green when he tried to get by him. Now he's putting tremendous pressure on him, looking to the inside off turn two.
Ned, the longer we run under a green flag run, the better Sterling Marlin looks.
Yes, that's the way he was in the very first run when the green flag dropped. It took him a little while to get by Dale Earnhardt Jr., but once he did, then he just took off, and like you say, the longer he ran, the better that car seemed to be. Now, that meant his car was not slowing down as much on the heated tires as some of the others were.
That's Brad Loney behind Tony Raines, showing a bit of smoke there. Is that a tire rub or is that out the header?
I would have to say it's tire rub. You can see the right side of the car right there putting out a lot of smoke. He did spin around a while ago and had some contact on the right side of the car, so that's the smoke. It's rubbing the tire somewhere.
Well, at these short tracks, racing is indeed a contact sport. For the lead, here comes Marlin and this partisan crowd of Tennessee race fans mostly on their feet as he goes after Jeff Green again.
He's sizing him up now, seeing where the weak points are on Green. He goes a little bit high there, and he'll try to dip down again, down to the inside and get a good run. He does, but not quite good enough this time to get his nose up there.
And then they're fixing to get in the lap traffic, and that changes everything. On the way you get in the corner, you have to time yourself just right. You see Blaney right there struggling just a little bit in the 93.
All right, Dave Blaney has fallen to the tail end of the lead lap and now gets lapped by Jeff Green. Let's go to Sterling Marlin's pit. Ralph?
Mike, this is Tony Glover. He is the crew chief for Sterling Marlin. Tony, it seems the longer you run, the better your tires go. Why is that?
Well, fortunately for us, the UT Chevrolet is really set up well in the long run. It takes it a while to come in, but it doesn't slow down much, so we're looking for a lot of green flag racing today.
Great run for Sterling Marlin. He's led a good portion of the laps here today so far. Now he trails Owensboro, Kentucky's Jeff Green, who also has a lot of laps and a championship at this track. Adam Petty, 45, gets underneath Matt Kenseth, fifth place.
Yeah, and you see Casey Atwood in the 27 there. He's turned it up a bit, too. He's moving back up through the field.
As was reported, Casey had a bad pit stop, but he's coming back now, not the way he did reading before.
Kenseth, the old man of this battle at 27. He's surrounded by 18-year-olds. You know, in most sports, that wouldn't be much of a story, but in Major League Stock Car Racing, it's only recently the drivers this young have got a chance at top equipment, top crews, and the opportunity to compete and be contenders at this level.
Mike, and the reason they start out in go-karts when they're 8 years old, and then they move into midgets and different things in racing, and they'll have as much experience at 20 years old as I had when I was 30.
But look at the three drivers at the lead are all 30 and over. Old age and treachery continues to lead youth and enthusiasm at Nashville. 133 laps are complete.
Beer, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
America Online users, for complete up-to-the-minute sports coverage, news, scores, and stats, go to keyword CBS Sportsline on America Online.
The address is CBS. Welcome home.
Besides having to deal with 42 drivers trying to dethrone him, Busch Series champion Dale Earnhardt Jr. also has to contend with the Bristol Motor Speedway. Understand it, you have to be there. See Dale Jr. and the rest of the Busch boys do battle on this unforgiving track. Tickets are available for the First American Pole Day and more snacks, $2.50. Experience racing the way it ought to be.
You missed a spot.
Presenting A Day at the Gordons, where racing champion Jeff Gordon and his wife Brooke eat new Fritos chili and scoops, a hearty cup of chili and loads of Fritos corn chips. It's fast, it's filling, it's Fritos. Perfect for people on the go. Delicious new Fritos chili and scoops. Nothing goes faster.
Futurecast, only on News Channel 7.
CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 is sponsored by Ford Expedition. The only way to get there. Ford Expedition, built Ford time. Smooth Busch Beer, an easy drinking Busch Light. Busch, the official sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series. And by Kinko's.
Welcome back to Nashville. 141 laps complete. Jeff Green continues to lead Sterling Marlin. Dave Blaney cut down a right front tire, lost at least two laps when he had to make a pit stop here under the green flag. But there is the separation between the leaders. With Todd Bodine in third, Jason Keller, Adam Petty in the top five today. Along with Casey Atwood, Matt Kenseth, Phil Parsons, Jeff Purvis, and Joe Nemechek. Here's Adam Petty, number 45. The two 18-year-olds going at it, Petty and Casey Atwood. Let's go back just a bit behind them to 10th place and Joe Nemechek.
See, almost 8,000. As a matter of fact, it was right on 8,000 down the straightaway there. A little over 125 miles an hour.
And you see, buddy, he gets a real good smooth run off the corner. You don't see that tack needle jumping around, spinning the tires coming off the turn.
Well, that car is hooked up and into the straightaway right at 8,000. He's hooked up, but what he has right now is terrible track position. You can see him really having a time with the cars. There's lap traffic there. There's cars that he's racing for position. He really can't get himself going right now.
It's our Bellsouth Mobility onboard cam as we look at the battle from fifth on back. 57, Jason Keller having a strong run today. He's got to pick a way through these lapped cars and lead Adam Petty and Casey Atwood through. He gets underneath Blaney. Now pulls down on Jason Jarrett.
Blaney had a tire problem not long ago, had to come in and change the right front. It was flat, and he just moved over and let these guys that are fighting it out for the first positions here go right on by.
Blaney is being shown four laps down.
And Jason gives way on the high side, but he's got a good enough car that it's not easy for Jason Keller to just drive on by. Now Petty and Atwood right with him. You know, Jason Jarrett, at 23 years old, is I guess just barely out of that kiddie core league of the 18 to 20 year olds in this field. But
he started his career a little bit later than some of these other guys. He did do the go-kart thing, but he was about 16 when he started the go-karts, and these guys were already in stock cars at 17.
21 cars on the lead lap, the last of those the Sadler brothers, Elliott and Hermie, and Mike McLaughlin, who, as we've seen, has had little luck finding the easy line through some of these accidents. That's McLaughlin, the Gould's Bumps camera, 1934 Chevy, pulling up on the 59 of Mike Dillon, former motocrosser. And here for fifth place, Adam Petty is underneath Jason Keller.
As they come up on Barry Bodine in the number 64 car, there's Casey Atwood, number 27.
Following right in the tire tracks of Adam Petty as they shoot off down the back straightaway there, coming off turn two. Great forward drive there on the 27 car of Atwood.
Jason Keller had to back off a little bit when he ran up on Barry Bodine. That cost him a little bit of time.
Well, you better take a picture of this, because you're going to see it for the next 20 years. These guys are going to go at it hot and heavy here. They'll move up to win the cup in a couple of years, and I tell you, that's the future of our sport. You're looking at it right there.
Your leaders, Jeff Green, Todd Bodine's moved up to second. Sterling Marlin is third. Let's go to Todd's pit, Dick Berger.
Well, Todd started the race in 11th spot, Mike, and he told me this morning that he really feels this place owes him one. He's only run this series twice. In 96, he was leading this race with 30 to go and got involved in a crash that wasn't his fault. That was the end of his day. 97, he lost it in the pits, still finished fifth. Adamant that they were going to not let anything go wrong today. They brought a brand new car. No test whatsoever. This is the test right here. It's running in second spot. Todd Bodine having a great day for himself.
Todd's pretty tickled. He called us this morning. It's the first brand new race car that he's had in several years.
Yeah, and you know, he's a very good mechanic. A lot of people don't understand that he has a background of working on these things for a long time before he ever got behind the wheel. So very talented mechanic, and he knows what to tell the crew to do the car. I look for him to do quite well with this team.
He built modifieds for Bob Cooney and Bobby V up in Connecticut. He's a great fabricator. And Casey Atwood has passed Adam Petty. That's for fourth place. So move Atwood back up the leaderboard. Jeff Green leads Todd Bodine, Sterling Marlin, and Casey Atwood.
Hate to tell you, but we're looking at a negative sales trend coupled with high overhead. Frankly, I'm worried about capital preservation. Let me put it this way. Look, we're just not meeting our goals. Tell you what, give me more eggs, I'll give you more corn. Otherwise, we may have to diversify.
Sometimes it's not just what you say, but how you say it. Kinko's, express yourself.
Introducing Doritos 3Ds. A whole new shape that begs to be eaten in very loud ways.
I Chihuahua.
Doritos 3D snacks. Same loud taste, new loud shape.
What would you have if you took the fastest growing sport in America today? Added millions of fans at races all across the U.S. Over 100 million more fans on radio and TV, and gave them a spectacular entertainment value. Filled with rising superstars in
incredibly fast racing and competition that's as good as it gets, you'd have the NASCAR Busch Series. The NASCAR Busch Series. This is NASCAR.
They're some of our favorite people. The millions of AutoZone customers who change their own oil. They're the kind of folks who believe that taking care of their car and saving money go hand in hand. And while we admire their willingness to tackle a dirty job, most of all, we thank them for bringing their used oil back to us. After all, used motor oil should be recycled, and that's one job we simply can't do alone.
Only one thing's better than the walk up 18 at Augusta National.
Mark O'Meara has won the Masters!
A tradition unlike any other, the Masters on CBS.
Coming up next on CBS Sports Spectacular, high energy of a wild and crazy sort when the Daredevils of the Slope show off at the Chevy S10 U.S. Snowboard Grand Prix from Sunday River, Maine. Then Doug Flutie, Warren Sapp, and many more battle to be the best at the Snapple Superstars. At Nashville, Tennessee, we are halfway in the Nashville 320, presented by Outback Steakhouse. Mike Joy with Buddy Baker and Ned Jarrett, Dick Bergeron and Ralph Shaheen on pit road. We've had three different leaders, pole sitter Dale Earnhardt Jr., Sterling Marlin, and Jeff Green. Several cautions, three of them. And three cars out of the race. Kevin LePage is back in the race 100 laps down.
Todd Bodine in car number 66 there has taken over second place, and now Sterling Marlin trying to get it back.
Well, he had it for a second. Yeah. You were right about that, but Sterling just powered up out of that corner. I know right now everybody's beginning to really conserve. Not long ago, Petty was called in. They told him, just be patient. It's too early in the race to race real hard. Make your line off the corner real smooth. Don't heat up the tires right now.
Looking back from Sterling Marlin, Tennessee Vols camp. Looking back at Todd Bodine, who may have one of the, he certainly right now got one of the three best cars here. Behind Jeff Green and Sterling Marlin, looking to the outside, drifting back down low. The youngest of the three racing brothers from Chemung, New York, his nephew Barry also in the field today. Now, when Sterling was on Todd Bodine's tail, Todd radioed in. He said his car was too loose, so he let Sterling go. Why?
Well, first thing you don't want to do is make the situation worse. And when you're out front there, you tend to overdrive to keep a guy behind you. So he dropped back. He's got somebody to gauge off of. Get down in the corner, back into throttle smooth. Don't get those tires too hot.
That's the fact that when another car is right on your back bumper, even at the speeds on this racetrack, it'll take a little bit of the air off of that spoiler and will tend to make that car loose. And that's, he didn't want to be in that situation, so he just made him go back and truck.
This is a short track. It's only 0.6 of a mile around, but they run 125 miles an hour down the straightaway and 80 to 85 in the corners. That's plenty fast enough for aerodynamics to play a big role.
Well, the one thing I always found, I never worried about aerodynamics that much here at Nashville, but one thing I did want to do is look out the windshield, not in the mirror. Once you start looking in the mirror, running that good line up out of the corner sometimes is a little awkward.
Jeff Green, your leader, number 32, trying to get past McLaughlin, and caution is out. Jimmy Kitchens has cracked the turn four wall. The Alabama driver who had to go to a backup car after a practice crash yesterday has Ageless Racing ace Red Farmer on the radio with him, his crew chief, but Kitchens has spun it around and backed it in.
And quite a few cars were fixing to go a lap down there that they'll have to come back in and make some adjustments. Some good race cars are still off as far as the handling.
There are some wheel marks on the opposite side, the right side of Kitchen's car. May have been. Of course, here you don't know if that's part of that incident or one that happened
somewhere
laps ago.
Yeah, just there's been so much close racing out there. He brings the car down. He tries to get to go. He doesn't know how much damage is done to the race car. Certainly, he wants to get it back into the pits and try to get repairs done.
That's what Mike was talking about. You see a tire mark right behind the wheel there.
Well, he's got more all the way up the right side, buddy, so it's hard to tell which one. I need to be Inspector Clouseau trying to figure that one out.
That one the further back there is probably the one that turned him. That one up there wouldn't bother you too much, but as you get towards the tail end of the race car, that has a lot to do with where the back goes.
Bobby Allison also in Jimmy Kitchen's pit today. Of the Alabama gang and all-time NASCAR greats.
Bobby's a consultant with this race team.
One of our favorites, and he has Red Farmer in there. they raced 1,000,000 miles together as teams and against each other. So quite a good team there. Kitchens will be good later on this year.
Todd Bodine, third place driver, said he was a little tight in the middle of the corner. We'll see if they make an adjustment when we come back.
We're here at a NASCAR race to take a survey. First question, does anyone sell as many high-quality auto parts as Napa? That'd be a no. Does anyone sell more hard-to-find parts than Napa? No again. Does anyone have as many ASE-certified employees? Last question, would you like to get paid for this survey? Just checking. Napa, over 200,000 parts, and everyone's important.
They sprayed us good, huh?
Yeah, good.
But I gotta tell you, my roots hurt real bad. Hank, whoever did this is gonna pay. Hank, they're gonna pay big. Hank, Hank.
Roundup, no root, no weed, no problem.
If you're the kind of person who'd rather tune an engine than eat, who reads a tachometer like a love story, for whom the roar of fully blown horsepower is a lullaby, have we got a machine for you. And in the hands of the right mechanic, it'll blow the doors off anything. Aim High, Air Force.
You're sweating like crazy.
You got TV cameras all over you.
The last thing you want is this white, clumpy thing running down your arm.
It's just rude.
We asked some of the hottest pros under the sun to switch antiperspirants.
Green invisible solid? What's that?
I would assume it goes on clear, but I'm not sure I believe that.
When your body heats up, the green invisible solid releases extra protection with a clear difference.
Right there. See, there's no white stuff. The harder I work, the harder it works.
No flaking, no funk, no Klingons.
Degree Invisible Solid works hard but never shows.
After the match, there's a ton of girls. Gotta be cool.
Joseph.
Yes, Papa.
There is an enemy that threatens all weeds. It is the spray.
So we'll bribe it.
The spray does not respond to bribes.
What's the world coming to?
Roundup. No root, no weed, no problem.
Ray's nervous about a romantic weekend getaway with his wife.
What are you afraid of? You guys still...
What?
Wow, wow, waka tow down, waka wow.
All new Raymond, CBS Monday.
Welcome back to Nashville Speedway and the Nashville 320 presented by Outback Steakhouse. 174 laps complete. Out of 320. Next week, CBS Sports presents a tradition unlike any other, the Masters. Defending champion Mark O'Meara leads the world's finest golfers to Augusta National. Late night highlights commence Thursday at 11:35 Eastern Time. Full coverage begins Saturday here on CBS Sports. The souvenirs are jumping off the shelves here behind the grandstand.
Probably
Nashville
some
Speedway.
Probably some of that stuff in there.
Oh, yeah, it'd have to be old. Yeah. That would be antique.
Yeah, the minute you get under caution, they go back in there and they buy, you know, T-shirts, hats. They love their drivers.
Working the caution flag here.
18 cars on the lead lap, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. was just a few seconds from going a lap down, but he pointed out there was some race cars that were looking for a caution because they were about to go a lap down.
Yeah, he was very close to getting lapped, and there were about 10 cars running along there that were great race cars.
The man who created the All-Pro Series, now part of NASCAR, and then became the promoter of Nashville Speedway, is going to hang it up at the end of this season, Bob Harmon.
Let me tell you what, guys, next year when you come back here, you'll find somebody else behind this microphone. After 50 years, old Harmon's going to hang it up. Going to lay back with my feet on the porch and talk to Dick Trickle some. So anyway, guys, I enjoyed it. Have a good, safe race. We'll see you after it's all over. Thank you.
See you
has been a great force in moving stock car racing to the position in sports that it enjoys today.
He certainly has. You know, maybe I should take a little tip from him, Mike. I learned here yesterday in talking with him that he is only about a month older than I am, and he's retiring. Now, you know, maybe I ought to know
that. Let me just tell you, you're going nowhere. You're staying with us.
Hey, this race is going somewhere. We're about to go green again.
You think of hanging it up, Ned. I'll lock that door before you can get out.
Green flag.
Back under green after the fourth caution of the day. Jeff Green leading Todd Bodine and Sterling Marlin and Casey Atwood to turn one. Now those lap cars on the inside, the leader's going to have to fight their way by.
They will. And they're lap cars, but they've made adjustments on these cars. They may be as quick as some of the cars that they're racing against there that are in the lead lap. So they can't just pull over and let them go. They have to race, and maybe they get that lap back.
Jeff Green well out ahead of that crowd now, but so is Todd Bodine. That's Sterling Marlin. He's still got some work to do there.
Yeah, it's always nice when you you're on the lead lap and you clear that first lap traffic and say, man, that feels good. And you go out there and run in clean air. Now Marlin's about to clear himself of it.
Let's go down to the leader's pit, Dick Bergeron.
Well, Jeff Green came into the pit stop round as the leader, went out as the leader. He just took one little adjustment to change the weight distribution on the car. Four tires, two cans of fuel. And as the crew told him, you're doing a great job driving it. He said, ha, when you're driving a Cadillac, when something handles as good as this, anybody could drive it. Meanwhile, Casey Atwood, who had that terrible pit stop earlier in the day, had a good pit stop this time. Went in fourth, came out fourth, still running to fourth.
Started the race with, they feel like they're in good shape to come to the front and hopefully win this thing. Matt Kenseth is very loose. He not only took one round of wedge, he took five rounds of wedge.
How big an adjustment is that?
Well, what you're doing there, you're putting more pressure on the spring so it in turn loads back into the car to make the pulling wheel get more traction and actually push the front of the car out. And that's the one thing you have to do. You have to stick. A lot of times I'd take a little bit of a loose race car over a pushing race car, but at this racetrack, I didn't want to be loose.
No, so. Well, we'll see how Kenseth, number 17, fares. He came out of the pits in seventh place. That's where he runs right now.
Yeah, about five rounds is a pretty big adjustment on these race cars. Normally, you think in terms of one or one and a half rounds.
He is underneath the 36, but whoa,
contact there, 10 feet away, and the 36 got very, very loose. Kenseth just touched him as they started off the corner. Now Nemechek's under him.
I was going to say Kenseth ran out of racetrack, and he did as he got into Fedewa. Now Tim Fedewa is one lap down in that number 36. Second place, Sterling Marlin moves underneath 66. Todd Bodine going into turn three.
And it looks like he's really hooked back up as we would just heard.
Trouble three. One car in the wall, that's Tony Roper. And he has hit it hard.
Yes, he has. Back to car number 61 into the wall. You see the left side up against the wall.
Caution is out, and Chuck Bound also has a lot of damage and a lot of smoke as he rounds turn two. Don't know if he was part of the accident. Maybe some right side damage that we don't see from this angle on Bound's car. So we're under caution again. It's the fifth one of the day.
Well, that's a lot of smoke, buddy. Is that tire smoke?
I'm not sure exactly what that is.
Well, I think it's coming out the left side header, as we saw it from the left side there, perhaps.
The one thing that did surprise me is he's going back around. I thought he would pull directly in. The pits was closed, but he looks like he needs some attention pretty quick here.
Now that's up from under the car. Hard to tell from this angle. There's the damage to Roper's car. And there's the front of Chuck Bound's machine.
Oh, the front part of the car is caved in. The left front corner is shoved back. You can see the shiny part of the tire there where it's rubbing some. But there's more problems than that. You can see the metal part of the car has a lot of smoke coming out of it.
It almost looks as if it's coming from the under the deck lid. You wonder if maybe it's a gearing problem, rear gearing problem.
It's the tail end of Tony Roper's bout into the wall. I saw him slide up and hit it, but did not see if there was any contact that caused it.
Well, Chuck Bowen was just behind him as they went in the corner there, but I wouldn't speculate without seeing.
Dick?
Well, nobody is pinning under this caution flag, Mike, because one of the rules in this series limits the number of tires each team can take under caution. Today, the rule is such that they can take just 3 tires per position under caution. Now, they've already taken 2 per position under the 2 prior caution flags. So everybody is playing it smart, and they're going to save their very best fresh tires for the tail end of the race. That's why there's no pit stops now.
NASCAR official holding Chuck Bowen there in the pits. He reported to the pit he was losing oil, light coming on inside the car, and Chuck Bowen is now done for the day. We're under caution, 188 laps complete here in Nashville.
He's got pride in his heart and dirt on his hands. There's one place to find a hardworking man. Look at that truck, Ford Country. Built Ford tough, Ford Country. When the work gets done, Ford Country. That goes. When friends get together and the work's all done, there's one place to go when the weekend comes, Ford Country. The whole world's Ford Country. Every place is Ford Country. Drive on out to Ford Country. Yeah, Ford Country. Ford Country.
Little Caesar is turning 40, and to celebrate, we're giving away free pizza. Now buy 2 pizzas for $11.97, get a free dessert and a free pizza on your next visit.
Pizza, pizza.
Whoa!
Weeds, huh, Pete?
Yeah.
Try Ortho Weed Be Gone. Kills weeds, won't harm your lawn. Guaranteed.
Didn't hurt my lawn.
Lawn weeds? Leave it to Ortho.
If what happened to him is any indication, doctors may have, just may have, taken a giant leap in the war on cancer. 60 Minutes, Sunday.
Tuesday on CBS, David James Elliott stars as the lieutenant commander who faces an impossible mission on the fastest growing drama on TV, JAG. Tuesday on CBS. Let's go to Dick Bergeron with former Busch Series champ Chuck Bowen.
And it's a very disappointed Chuck Bowen behind the wall. A lot of smoke. What happened to that thing?
Well, I'm not really sure. I think we damaged an oil line or something. I got together with the 61 car down the backstretch. He was trying to take me on the inside. Tried to slide up in front of me, but, you know, up against the wall, which was my lane, I didn't lift, and I got a little more damage than I was hoping I'd get out of the deal. So kind of a bad deal in hindsight. I wish I'd lifted. I didn't think I hurt anything, but obviously we did. We hurt something pretty serious. I think we're out of the race. I don't think we can get it back in there. It's too bad for Exxon, Superfoam Motor Oil, but there's next week at Bristol.
How is the line at this point, Chuck? Is it beginning to move upstairs as it usually does at Nashville?
I've been running upstairs kind of all night. I think it's a little bit easier on the tires. We were still one lap down. We weren't that great, but we were hoping for a decent, respectable finish, but it's not going to happen. But basically, guys are running all over the racetrack. Depends on what your chassis is doing.
Chuck Bowen, he's out of it for today.
Well, we've talked a lot, Dick, about young drivers who have made their mark here at Nashville and had success here early in their careers. Some of those 18-year-olds. That number 15 at Norris Ford, that is Bud Moore's car, and that is Buddy Baker behind the wheel. But who is in the 33?
33. Wow. I know it's not Harry Gant.
Well, I'll tell you, that car is sponsored by country star Farron Young, and the driver, former national champion Buck Baker, Buddy's dad.
Wow. And he let me go by.
Buddy, was that before color film was invented?
Right. Yep. And those tires really did have air in them.
A picture from the Nashville Speedway program back about, I think, 1973 or so.
Yeah, Bud Moore, great mechanic. I really enjoyed driving for him.
Never knew your dad ran number 33.
Neither did I.
No, program said that was Buck Baker.
Okay. And I'll buy it.
Let's go to pit road.
Mike, driver Sterling Marlin is not the only one in the member of this 14 crew who is a big fan of the Tennessee Volunteers. Crew chief Tony Glover, once when he was working for the Morgan McClure Winston Cup team, drove all the way from their shops in Virginia to New Orleans to see the Vols in action. Just so happens on the way, the car that he was driving broke down in Alabama. A series of taxi cabs and fights with repair shop owners and three meals at the same Waffle House later, Tony saw the game, still made it all the way back to Virginia for work the next day.
That's a dedicated fan.
And Tony's is one of the best crew chiefs in the business of auto racing, NASCAR racing.
A look at the Busch Series points. The drivers displayed in yellow are not here. So either Matt Kenseth, Mike McLaughlin, Elton Sawyer, or perhaps defending champ Dale Earnhardt Jr. could leave here with the point lead after this seventh race of the year. There's the top half dozen.
That was coming into the race here today. So really, when Matt Kenseth took the green flag today, he basically moved into the lead in the point standings, but we don't have the outcome of the race yet. That's when they count it. You're giving the signal now for one more lap. We'll go back to green.
The leader is Jeff Green, going for his second Busch Series career win. He won at Las Vegas in 1997 in his 100th career start in the series. Today is his 122nd race. And he'll be fighting with Elliott Sadler on the bottom of the racetrack in the number 47. Andy Santerre expected back by Dover in that car. And Elliott trying to get back on the lead lap. Now, Mike McLaughlin may well be at the tail end of the lead lap. We'll double check that.
Well, boy, oh boy. Just
yeah, or excuse me. I'm mistaken.
He is back at the back of the
well
pack.
Back.
Yeah,
yep.
Well back at the back. This track might be pretty slick here on the restart because he put a lot of that quick dry down in the turns.
All right, let's get set for this restart. Kentucky driver Jeff Green to lead them down ahead of Tennessee's Sterling Marlin. And this time they both clear the lap car. Here comes Todd Bodine on the outside.
Elliott Sadler is that lap car, number 47. He won't, he'll give them room to race, and he did, and Todd Bodine gets by.
Buddy Marlin's looking like he wants the lead.
He's looking to the bottom now as they come off turn two. He's adjusted on his car, but Green, as you see him getting down in turn three, running right in the middle of the racetrack, it's hard to get a position to get by him coming out of the corner.
18 cars on the lead lap. The last of those is Jeff Fuller, along with Bobby Hillen and Tony Raines, Randy LaJoy and Mike McLaughlin. Here goes Marlin to the inside. He's got position.
Almost. Now, Green gives him a little room there. He should make a move right out of the turn here, but you see Green got a lot of forward bite coming out of that corner and just took it away from him.
He really did. He got good traction coming off of that corner. Green's car doesn't seem to be working quite as good down on the inside there now as we had seen it in the past.
All right, those two in the lead. Todd Bodine right with him. He's right on Marlin's back bumper. Let's go to Todd's pit, Ralph.
Mike Buddy was talking about how much forward bite Green got and how that allowed him to stay in front of Sterling Marlin. That's something Todd Bodine wishes he had. He's not getting all the forward bite he would like. He's looking for one round of wedge on the next pit stop.
Those three have cleared the lap traffic. Jason Keller, Casey Atwood, Adam Petty have not yet.
Mike, the crew chiefs just have to be pulling their hair out. One moment, it's cloudy here. The next moment, the sun's out. Right now, the sun's beating down on this racetrack, and it's changing as we speak.
120 laps to go, and Marlin continues to put the pressure on.
Yeah, you want to fill that mirror up as much as possible. Every once in a while, I'd kind of dig him a little bit, give him a little shot, let him know I'm still there, just so he'd keep an eye on me and maybe miss that line just a little bit and give me a room to get under him.
Green's car seems to be working a little bit better up in that second groove than Sterling's, and that lets him get that traction coming off of the corner.
And Marlin's car, Ned, seems to be better without another car in front of it. As soon as Sterling's gotten the lead at any time or gotten ahead of a pack of cars, he's been able to scoot away.
Good to have a little bit of aero push when he gets up behind another car. Now he's trying it down on the inside once again, but there again, Green gets the fraction off the turn.
Buddy, does it look like Marlin is driving his own line or working against whatever line Jeff Green is running?
I think at the moment what he's doing, he's racing the track and not the 32 there of Green. He's looking for a place that he might pick up a little bit of forward bite, maybe close in a little bit. But what he's doing right now is just keeping pressure on him. As long as he's sitting there, he still has a chance later on to put extreme pressure on him.
Here's Ralph in the leader's pit.
Second here with Chad Little back in 1995. Because the track had deteriorated here in Nashville so much since they repaved it in 1996, he went back to the setup notes that he used with Chad Little's car in 95. As far as Sterling Marlin's crew is going right now, they're not worried at all about Jeff Green in front of them. They're just giving Sterling the times every time by, letting Sterling be patient, save those tires.
Right, Ralph, they know that the longer they run under the green flag, the better Sterling Marlin's car gets, and it may be to the point where he can pass Jeff Green without abusing and wearing down the tires on his car. Jeff Green, meanwhile, has his own game plan, and it's stay in front. Todd Bodine is third. Great run for Jason Keller today, the fourth place car, and Casey Atwood, second here last year, and a big shocker. Running fifth right now. Number one, Randy LaJoy gets underneath Mike McLaughlin. That is for 13th position. Watching from the Gould's Pumps cab, mounted at on the leading edge of the roof of Mike McLaughlin's car. Last year's winner of this race, McLaughlin, now 14th. Let's ride with Stanton Barrett. Channel lock cam, show you a little onboard telemetry. See if that needle jumps coming up off the corner if the tires spin. Nope.
Brad Loney there, he was in the spin earlier in the race. Jason Jarrett right there in the 33 on the bottom side of the racetrack. Wow, they're pretty consistent, right close to 8,000 RPM.
Barrett tried the high side on Jarrett, that didn't work. Now he's gonna go to the low side. Didn't work.
Back up front, Sterling Marlin still trying to size up Green, but Green is hanging tough.
Ned, he's running a line right now. He's got half the car in the low line, half of it in the next lane, so it'd be tough to find a place to pass him. You have to catch him when he moves out and stick the car right up under him to get by him, because Green is really running a defensive race right now.
And if they expect this is going to be a long green flag run, there's no sense in abusing those tires too early. CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 continues after this message and a word from your local station.
Get a grip on it. Tools that built the USA. Get a grip on it. Grip on it.
When you need a grip on life's little challenges, get a grip on Channel Lock.
Walker's girlfriend is kidnapped.
Some kind of paramilitary outfit.
And the Sons of Thunder try to get her back. It's all new CBS Tonight.
Thanks for making CBS America's most watched network. Welcome home.
Attention! Please pardon this interruption, but we're presenting an offer from Nasonex, a coupon for a free one-month trial. For information and a coupon for a free one-month trial, call 1-800-680-4600. Talk to your doctor to find out whether Nasonex is right for you. The call and the offer are free, so call today. 1-800-680-4600.
I think that when WSBA really looked at it and saw it was a serious matter, that gave it a great deal of significance and credibility.
An exclusive News Channel 7 I-Team investigation leads to controversial legislation.
No question about it. I think the investigation the I-Team did, I think was a great motivator.
It's the story that got the nation talking, and you got it first from the News Channel 7 I-Team. Keep your eye on them. Precise pinpoint Doppler. See the weather from exactly where you live. No rules, just right.
For the lead, Sterling Marlin tries the inside on Jeff Green. He's been just diving down there these last three or four laps, eating away at the bottom side of the racetrack.
Ned, he's not giving up. He's still looking for that inside groove coming up out of the corner. If he ever draws side by side, I think he'll make the pass. But right now, he's working extremely hard, and he's laying on those tires pretty hard, too, I'd say.
Those cars are very evenly matched, and Green hasn't made a mistake yet. Marlin keeps that pressure on, though.
A little bit loose with Jeff Green off the corner that time. 100 laps to go. Let's go to Ralph on pit road.
Mike, they just radioed to Sterling and said, well, if you can't pass him, just aggravate it.
Well, he's aggravating.
Here it goes, and we have a smoker, Randy LaJoy, in turn one. They're racing back to the flag here. I'm sure the caution will be out.
No caution yet.
And LaJoy gets it back down to the track apron. And it looks like everybody's getting through that corner. Little slip and slide as Casey Atwood slides up into the 47 of Elliott Sadler.
Yeah, but the racetrack, he got off the groove pretty quick there, Randy LaJoy did. He's a seasoned veteran, so he didn't stay out there and oil up the track. Yellow is out.
LaJoy coasts in. And caution will come onto the speedway for the sixth time today. Last week at Texas, we're going to put Randy LaJoy in relief of Bobby Hamilton. And LaJoy did not get in the car, and I said that it was because he did not fit the seat. Randy came up this week, and he says, I've lost 20 pounds. He says, really, the reason he did not get in the car was that it featured a different type of seat than what LaJoy prefers and feels is the safest seat from his experience. So he chose not to get into the car, and another driver got in relief. Now, there is a look at Randy's seat. And you can see that it encapsulates the shoulders on each side rather than the rib cage, as do the seats preferred by some other drivers. And Randy has come up with a company to build those seats. Now, there's a seat that rests around the rib cage.
Yeah, you can see that that's further down. And that is a rib cage restraints there. And when you hit 9 out of 10 times with this seat, you do a little damage to the rib cage.
LaJoy felt he would rather take that side load in an accident at the shoulder rather than the rib cage. They're just different schools of thought that different drivers have on what's safest.
Yeah, and I admire Randy for the work that he did in designing that seat. Now, as we see all of the leaders coming down pit road, this should be their last pit stops. They got a little less than 100 laps to go.
Like Matt Kenseth also has a LaJoy seat in his car today. Well, let's check pit stops, starting with Nick Berggren.
And I'm in Jeff Green's pit. He was second in this race in 97. Hasn't won it. They just made an adjustment to the chassis. He's still a little loose coming out of the corners. Green has a second and a third in the 1998 season. Only one win in this series. That in 97. He surely hopes today will be the second, and he's looking real good. Slow on the rear tires. Really slow on the rear tires. That was a slow, bad pit stop as a result. 25.10. Ralph.
19.96 for Sterling Marlin's bunch. A tremendous stop down here. They went at it with no pressure. They know their driver has really got a good race car. They went with exactly the same setup that they had on the last one, which, if you remember, was just how they started the day off. Tony Glover radioed into Sterling, said, we're going to give you exactly what you had before this thing got underway. Looked like you're having a ball. Sterling said, you bet I am.
Now, Joe Nemechek came into the pit sixth, and he may have come out the first he did of the drivers who made pit stops. There's a look at Nemechek.
Boy, track position, you bet. Track position, so important here. Have that clean racetrack for lap after lap where everybody else is racing, people trying to get by and everything. It's very important to be in the lead.
Now, Casey Atwood is the one that made a good pit stop. We talked earlier that he made a bad pit stop or two earlier. Those guys made a good one this time and got him back out in either fourth or fifth position.
And that trouble on Jeff Green left him in eighth place at the end of the round of pit stops. I'll show you what caused the problem here. Down in turn one.
Randy LaJoy down on the inside. You see that smoke coming from his Chevrolet.
Now you watch how quick he gets that thing out of the racing groove. He's trying to catch the back right there, and now he's back down on the flat part of the racetrack, out of harm's way there.
He said on the radio to his crew, the motor just quit. We're done for the day.
Well, that was unfortunate. He was in good shape to win his third championship.
Look at the drivers who have won this year, starting with Randy LaJoy at Daytona. Jeff Burton, Mark Martin, neither of whom are here, nor is Mike Skinner today. Matt Kenseth, winner at Darlington, and Mark Martin last week in Texas. Adam Petty comes back in, and they have a clear plastic film on the windshield that to pick up debris
stop,
and all,
Adam,
and they
stop,
can take
stop.
That off. To give him a clear view the rest of the race.
Now that would tell me that he was probably behind LaJoy when the engine let go and he got a windshield full of oil and they had to come back in and take that off so he could see the racetrack.
Tough though to give up sixth place because he'll come back out at the end of the lead lap in 18th.
And as heavy as we've seen traffic here, that's going to be very, very tough. And we're getting ready to go.
Now, if Joe Nemechek, number 87, only took two tires, he may still have some tires to get as this race winds down if there's another caution.
There were a lot of cars that were not ready for this restart. A lot of the lap cars had not pulled up on the inside. I don't know if they missed the queue or what happened, but the traffic is not as heavy as it could have been.
Surely not. The lead car one or more laps down was Joe Buford, last year's Nashville Speedway champ. And the 47 there is a lap down. That is Elliott Sadler.
The 14 of Sterling Marlin certainly was ready, as you see him already now in second place on the racetrack and also on the position wise. As Matt Kenseth there in the 17 gets under the 47 there.
Very strung out restart. And it's Joe Nemechek up on point for the first time today.
Boy, it didn't take Sterling long to catch him, Ned. He ran him down from about 10 car lengths and just two laps there. You see Sterling looking on the inside of Nemechek coming down the front straightaway.
And he won't have the problem passing him that he had trying to get around Jeff Green. Look, he goes right down on the inside, right on the apron of the racetrack, gets traction coming off the corners. And when he goes into turn three, he's basically going to have him passed.
Well, Ned, if Nemechek took only two tires, Sterling Marlin has four fresh ones, which at this stage would give him quite an advantage.
No question.
Yeah, Matt Kenseth has already caught the 87 there, Nemechek. Like you said, four tires are essential here.
So let's ride behind the leader with Joe Nemechek, Bellsouth Mobility Cam.
Coming off turn four down the front straightaway, already 7,500, 8,000 down the straightaway, about 125 miles an hour down at the far end of the straightaway.
That's the kind of speeds and the RPMs that we've seen here most of the day.
Well, Nemechek has a mirror full of Matt Kenseth, then it's Todd Bodine in fourth, and Jeff Green has come from eighth on the restart up to fifth.
He is on the move. He has a good race car, and here goes Kenseth trying to take over second, going into turn three. Gets down on the inside of Nemechek, makes the pass.
Took a wide line going in there, making Nemechek go a little higher than he wanted to, but that's your option. When you make that move on the bottom, you can use up a lot of racetrack.
Let's check with Ralph. Up for that 32 of Jeff Green. He's working the bottom on Todd Bodine. He restarted eighth. He's up to fourth.
He does have a fast race car, and Mike, not only getting back there to eighth and having to pass these cars is going to hurt him because he's using up more tires right now than he would like to use, and he has his last set of tires on, and he's got to be very careful here.
And the other thing, Todd Bodine in the 66 is fighting as hard as he can to keep him from getting by. As I say that, he makes a move. Casey Atwood just behind there trying to take Jason Keller over there for the
That's sixth place, and that's a battle for position because Keller's had a really good run today.
Yes, he has, and pit stops have been extremely good. Casey Atwood a few times has dropped back a little on pit stops, but boy, the car is a lightning bolt down the straightaway.
Just ahead of them, Jeff Green gets underneath Nemechek. There's the 32, moving up to third on the leaderboard.
Well, those two tires just not working for Nemechek, but maybe it will work for him if he gets a late caution. That would let him come in and get those other two tires.
Sterling Marlin leads Matt Kenseth, Joe Nemechek, Jeff Green.
Little voice in your head makes you feel guilty for having too much of a good thing. Yeah, we don't either.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Busch Beer, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
Craig, I don't know.
Fair enough. Maybe this will help.
As you can see, I love you more than anything in the world.
Note the dramatic increase in the past 7 months. This shows how much we have in common. My 10-year gross earnings potential. A composite of what our kids might look like.
I like what you've done here, Craig.
Sometimes it's not just what you say, but how you say it. Kinko's. Express yourself.
What do you look for in grass seed? Quick results?
We seeded it with Scott's seed last fall. As soon as I planted it, boom, it just came in.
A really terrific lawn?
And it feels like crushed velvet under your feet. It's wonderful.
How about weeds? Bargain brands can contain thousands of weed seeds that can ruin your lawn forever.
You can spend a dollar or two less for a bag of seed.
But you don't want weeds in your grass seed.
Scott's Premium Grass Seed, 99 and 99 100% weed-free for a beautiful lawn guaranteed.
America Online users, for complete up-to-the-minute sports coverage, news, scores, and stats, go to keyword CBS Sportsline on America Online.
Coming up next, CBS Sports Spectacular, the Chevy S10 U.S. Snowboard Grand Prix. And then, Doug Flutie, Warren Sapp, and many more battle at the Snapple Superstars. Here at Nashville Speedway, 246 laps complete, 74 to go. Casey Atwood moves underneath the 87 of Joe Nemechek to pick up fourth place. While we were away, Nemechek surrendered what was then third place to Matt Kenseth. And there's Todd Bodine, Jason Keller battling with Jeff Purvis. Those are all lead lap cards.
And Earnhardt.
Here's a look at the move as Jeff Green right now appears to be the fastest car on the racetrack for Jeff Green and then Matt Kenseth.
Kenseth realized he was much quicker, just moved over and let him go. What a battle this is. And look at Earnhardt. He's turned it up here and moved into contention now.
And here Green has caught Sterling Marlin.
Oh, one car. I think that's Fedewa very, very hard into the wall in turn one. That is Tim Fedewa. Turn around and backed it in and stove in the rear bumper area and sheet metal all the way to the fuel cell. He's okay.
Well, this track has not been too good to Tim Fedewa. I think he had a third here a couple years ago, but he also got upside down and I think was in practice here last year.
There's Fuller. You see a lot of damage to the front of his car.
Jeff Fuller was toward the tail end of the lead lap battling with Adam Petty, Tony Raines.
Now you wonder, as you see Tim Fedewa looking very disgustedly, wonder if he's going to be looking at somebody there. Let's see if we can see what happened. Well, he'd already lost control by the time the camera picked it up.
Yeah, he was Fuller. In the wall when Fuller got into him.
Yeah, but That was Jeff Fuller, who was also involved.
Whoops, he's pointing at somebody.
That was Jeff Fuller.
Okay.
Tim Fedor is not happy with.
Wow. Pretty good athlete.
Yeah.
He clears those fences and goes right on.
Straight into the garage area with a little extra adrenaline needing to be used up there. Tim Fedewa abandoning his car, crashed against the fence, and there is the evidence of some of the contact between he and Jeff Fuller. At Nashville, 251 laps complete. We're working the seventh caution of the afternoon.
It knows two speeds. Stop and go. It just beat a series of the toughest stop-and-go driving tests in the world, and it's brand new. Go ahead. Guess.
Guess.
You have 4.3 seconds. Introducing Pennzoil with new Pure Base. Stop. Go. Pennzoil.
It is more than a trial by fire. It is a rite of passage. And if you can master your fear, outsmart your enemy, and never yield, even to yourself, you will be changed forever. The few, the proud, the Marines.
For those smokers who are ready to quit, Nicorette introduces a breath of fresh air. New mint-flavored Nicorette gum. The same craving-fighting power of Nicorette and the flavor of mint. Nicorette helps you control your cravings so you can break free from smoking. And now you can choose your flavor. Now isn't that a breath of fresh air?
Nicorette helps you fight your cravings, your habit, your way. You can do it. Nicorette can help.
The reason for coming to Home Depot, number one, is me.
Ooh, did I get you?
I use most of the equipment here myself. I can't think of any piece of power equipment here I don't use.
Don't worry, I like the tree.
So therefore, I feel comfortable talking to you, the customer, and telling you what you should be using. I have everything that you're going to need, no matter what size yard that you're taking care of.
Toro, Scotts,
Black & Decker,
Honda,
Hoolan,
Longboy.
This is my candy store. I got all my tools.
CBS Sports Race Summary is sponsored by the Home Depot, the official home improvement warehouse of NASCAR.
Laps. We've had five different leaders, seven lead changes, and we're close to a record pace for this race. Seven caution flags for 40 laps, and off the track, Tim Fedewa, Randy LaJoy, Chuck Bown, along with Justin Labonte, Dick Trickle, and the 79 of R.D. Smith. Let's show you again what we have of this crash in turn one. It's really after the initial contact that started it.
Mike, the wreck actually started way back up the straightaway there. We see the end results there because Fuller had a lot of damage before he ever made contact the second time there with Fedewa.
Well, let's find out from Tim Fedewa what happened. Let's go to the garage.
Tim, what took place out there?
Ask Jeff Fuller. I think he would probably tell you better. I don't know, man. I just get aggravated at stuff like that when you know you can see a wreck about to happen and people drive off the end of their hood like that. It just, I'm just not going to say nothing because I don't have nothing nice to say about it, but I would like to say thanks to Stanley. They're a great sponsor, and they've been suffering through this with us, and we'll get it right for them. It's just not been our year so far, but got a good team. We'll get it together.
Is it adrenaline from something like that that allows you to hop that fence as big as you did?
I don't want to say what it is. I'm just a little teed right now. A little adrenaline and a lot of anger.
Well, from Tim's comments, you could infer that some car must have got sideways in front of him and he checked up. Jeff Fuller ran in the back of Fedewa, and it was Fedewa's car that ended up wrecked.
Sounded that way.
We're under caution with 254 laps complete.
Jack forgot his briefcase.
I can see him.
Don't worry. We both have Nextel.
He's crossing the street. Phone him.
Nah, it's too easy. I can text page him. Yeah, where's the fun in that?
If he gets to the airport without the presentation, we're dead.
Time for the secret weapon. Two-way radio feature. Right about now.
Hey, Jack.
Hold up, my man. I think you... Jack?
Nextel's integrated features make ordinary cell phones seem ordinary.
For Dan and Lisa, it just clicked. So they loaded up their Ford Expedition and got back to doing what they love. Answering the call of the wild.
I lost them.
And they unleashed a beast of their own. That big 5.4-liter Triton V8.
Gotcha.
And you thought Little Red Riding Hood got a close look. Ford Expedition. Built Ford tough.
We're gonna change your mind about coloring your gray with the natural look of Just for Men.
You look so natural, no one can tell with Just for Men. No one can tell with Just for Men.
Just for Men penetrates hair deep inside where natural color begins. Simply apply, and in 5 minutes, rinse. Gray is gone, matched up to the rest of your hair.
You look so natural, no one can tell with Just for Men.
You might think this start could cause serious engine damage. But surprisingly, this cold engine start could cause more damage. That's why Exxon Superflow Motor Oil races to protect vital engine parts right from the start, when significant engine damage can occur. For these racing teams, there is only one winning formula. Exxon Superflow. For protection that's fast. Protection that lasts.
If I don't eat something in the next minute, I will die.
It's a party so fancy, they don't have food.
Chewable vitamin C's.
The King of Queens.
Oh, God, not chewable.
An all-new episode, CBS Monday.
Welcome back to Nashville Speedway and the Nashville 320, presented by Outback Steakhouse on CBS this afternoon. Off the super speedways and on to the short tracks for NASCAR's Busch Series. Let's check with Dick Bergman.
Tony Glover, the crew chief for the leading driver, Sterling Marlin, just ambled on down pit road and had a conversation with Harold Holly. He is the crew chief for the second place driver, Jeff Green. I asked Harold, I said, what was that all about? And he said, well, Tony and I have arrived at the conclusion that together we are faster than the cars behind us. So the plan is we're going to run together until the end of this race, and then we're going to have a shootout. And then Holly looked at me with sort of one of those askance views and said, but you know how plans go.
Yeah, and I'm going to tell him something else. Look in the mirror at that 27 car, Casey Atwood, when they start back here. I don't think he's out of this thing at all.
Robert Burns, the best laid plans of mice and men, they have to glee.
Oh, green, 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 green,
we are racing.
Lead lap cars in the outside lane. Sterling Marlin breaks free of traffic. He's off and running.
And Jeff Green didn't get by that lap car. Mike Dillon down on the inside in car number 59.
Green's going to have a little more work to do here, and he's got a mirror full of Matt Kenseth.
Yeah, boy, he doesn't need this. He needs to get clear of that car so he can run his own line around the racetrack and not have to abuse his tires.
Sterling's up there going, all right, this is working in my favor right now. I have the whole racetrack to use up.
Also up in that top lane is 25, Kenny Wallace. Now, the lap cars only have to stay on the bottom lane until they come to the start.
Oh, trouble off turn two.
Spinning around is Hank Parker Jr. He is down against the wall, and everyone will safely come around to the caution flag.
Well, the caution was not waving.
Goodness,
he's going again, or at least he got it righted. The leaders are coming around.
We're going to stay green.
Yeah. So there you see Parker's car, the yellow car, down on the inside. He'll probably head to the pits. I imagine he has a tire flat on it.
Boy, that turn two is treacherous. I don't care how many times you've been off that corner. Just a little mistake there, and around you'll go.
Buddy, he was lucky he didn't touch the outside wall and kept spinning around to the inside wall out of harm's way.
Yeah, he was lucky nobody was on either side of him, too.
Well, Ned, if you're Matt Kenseth right now in that third-place car behind these two, how hard do you run with this many laps to go?
Well, you run as hard as you possibly can and not spin and slide those tires. And I expect that's what he's thinking right now. He would like to see those guys get up there and race side by side because that would abuse their tires. And he could see what would happen there, and he could just keep his car as straight as possible.
From Joe Nemechek.
sense any contact. Look at that inside wall. You think he in right again? Yeah, he makes contact there just a little bit with the right side of the car.
And for the lead. What was that plan again?
Sterling Marlin. He's leading. Jeff Green, of course, wants that lead. Right now, Jeff Green is quicker. He's running down from about 15 car lengths back, and he's less than, well, I wouldn't put my hand in between the two.
Ed, would you pass him now or would you ride?
If the car is capable of passing, I think I'd go ahead and do it if I didn't have to abuse my car too much. And when I say my car, basically it's the tires.
Listen to me. If you're hungry, eat. If the car is working, I want it. I want up front. I want them to have to make the move on me. As I speak, race for the lead.
Here comes Green on the inside. Will Marlin let him go? Not hardly.
He's going to make him use those tires up down on the inside. And the inside car will abuse the tires more than that guy on the outside.
Sterling gets good grip down in the corner. Green just inches off of him there. Almost contact getting into that corner.
And they drop back single file. Well, Jeff Green may let the tires cool a bit by not abusing that car on the bottom of the racetrack and then take another run.
Back behind them, Casey Atwood's having all kind of trouble trying to get by Wallace. He's pretty much out of the game right now unless he can make that move and get on going.
2 leaders continue to hold 1-2. Let's check with Dick Bergeron.
Hank Parker Jr., who just spun around, is out of the car on pit road on his back, Mike. Not feeling well at all. He has been replaced in the car by Tim Fedelaw.
Thanks, Dick. Boy, Jeff Green up and under Sterling Marlin.
Yeah, this thing's going to get, I think you're going to see some great short track racing. Maybe a little bumping and rubbing here because he's, as I speak, I thought he made contact there.
And Matt Kenseth sitting back there looking. This is exactly what he wanted to see up in front of him, like we talked a moment ago. He's just sitting there running his car straight, and these guys up there going at it.
And Casey Atwood has finally gotten by the lap traffic now. We can see if he can hunt down the leaders.
Boy, you could get convicted of contact if you were Jeff Green. That's how close they were.
He's got to run again. This time, Rena gets a good run.
Oh, makes the pass going down in there.
Sterling, I don't know.
Sterling sideways.
He's got a flat tire.
And takes Kenseth with him. Matt Kenseth spins to the inside, and everybody's got to thread the needle to come to the caution flag.
Sterling Marlin did a very smart thing. Locked the brakes up. Did not come down into this traffic. That would have been a huge wreck if he hadn't locked the brakes up.
And Kenseth is having a hard time getting going. He backs up the racetrack. And he's going to get away, and now Marlin as well. So neither of them should go a lap down. They'll both come on pit road for repair.
Left rear tire.
I knew something had to happen to Marlin's car. As he came off of turn two, the car just slid just a little bit and slowed, and that gave Jeff Green the run that he needed, and then he went into the turn. Of course, it was obvious that the tire had gone down because he spun around.
And Matt Kenseth catching up to Sterling Marlin, that proved to be his downfall.
Yeah, because you're going down in that corner probably 125 miles an hour, and you don't just stop right away.
Now, we said they were out of tires. Now, in this case, Sterling Marlin can come in and get a tire. He can get the left rear tire because it is flat.
And he has a lot of front end damage also, so he's not going to be up to full song like he was before this wreck.
That will leave Jeff Green with Casey Atwood, Jason Keller, Joe Nemechek, and Todd Bodine behind him. Let's have a look at it here. Watch the 14.
You can see the back of the car there. The left rear is already flat. He turns around. Look at Kenseth. Little contact there on the left front corner. As Sterling goes up, he locks the brakes and does not come back down the racetrack.
As we watch it again, the back end, just because he has no traction on that left rear. And here's Kenseth coming in there, and the yellow number 17 gets just a little piece as their front ends hit, and Kenseth spins down to the inside.
And Ned, Kenseth also impacted the inside retaining wall as down in turn number 4 with the nose of that car. So he has more damage than from just the slight bit of contact you'll see right there.
And you wonder if that close racing that Green and Marlin were doing together, if maybe Green might have got against him just a little bit and against that left rear tire. Maybe clip the valve stem or something like that as we see the end of the accident again.
Well, let's ride with Sterling Marlin into turn 3.
He's coming off of turn 2. He knows he has a flat tire.
He knows that. Down the back straightaway, you could hear him check up just a little bit there. He had had problems halfway down the back straightaway.
Now, here's what Joe Nemechek saw.
Now, that's a split-second decision you have to make.
Now, Matt Kenseth will come in to check the front tires on his number 17, and he won't be allowed to change one unless those tires are flat.
And Sterling's car apparently won't get back to his pits. He stopped up there.
Crew came down to try to give him a push.
Ned, sometimes when you have a flat like that, the rubber will roll up around the back wheel and won't allow it to turn.
And the crew's being sent back behind the wall. Ralph?
Mike, their initial thought on why the car stopped is a battery. That's what they're going to try to change first. They are only going to be allowed to change that left rear tire. The battery, we're told now, is completely gone. So they've got one ready down here. They're trying to find out if the cable is still there on the battery, just how much of this they're going to have to replace. They do know that it is a battery problem. They've got one ready. When he gets down here, they're going to change the battery and change that left rear tire only. They tried to lobby with NASCAR to see if they could get left front as well. NASCAR said, no, just the left rear.
The reason for that, Mike, you know where the battery's at.
Well, just ahead of that left rear wheel well, and when that tire disintegrated and started flailing around inside the wheel well, it took out the battery. Pit stops continue under the caution flag here at Nashville with two of the contenders perhaps taken out of the game.
Can build you a PC that lets you be who you want to be, like a Gateway Essential PC with an Intel Celeron processor for as low as $28 a month, and you can trade it in toward the purchase of a new one in 2 years. Call 1-800-GATEWAY.
That's me, Bill.
Here we are at the Super 8.
For reservations, call 1-800-800-8000.
Whoa!
Weeds, huh, Pete?
Yeah.
Try Ortho Weed Be Gone. Kills weeds, won't harm your lawn. Guaranteed.
Didn't hurt my lawn.
Lawn weeds? Leave it to Ortho.
It's the greatest racing on earth.
Excitement! Speed!
The driver!
It's a rush! Acceleration and acceleration.
Family fun.
Fast cars.
Top trucks.
The NASCAR Winston Cup Series. The NASCAR Busch Series. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. This is NASCAR.
NASCAR is racing.
Busch Beer, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
If what happened to him is any indication, doctors may have, just may have, taken a giant leap in the war on cancer. 60 Minutes, Sunday.
Monday night on CBS. Guys, have you ever been conned into a romantic weekend getaway where there's no TV? We feel your pain. See how Ray handles it on an all-new Everybody Loves Raymond, Monday on CBS. Sterling Marlin's car has been rolled back to the garage area, and he's climbed out. Damage, too bad to continue. Ralph Shaheen.
Sterling, what happened?
32 got against us in a corner. We just racing, was having a good time, and I guess the spinner cut the left rear tire down and went out in three. The rest of the air went out, spun, and it wasn't hurt too bad. And trying to get caught up, and the left rear blew out, shrapnel, and tore the battery out of it. Run out of power. Get pushed down here in the pits, and the record told us out. So, been a heck of a day. But I'd like to thank Tennessee Volunteers and all the boys at Savco that built a real good race car, and Goodyear, and Moog, and Champion, a whole bunch. And we had a good time. It's fun.
Mike, as they pushed that car into the garage area back here, there was another tow truck sitting right in front of Sterling as he ran to the corner, and he got on the brakes, and the tow push truck just kept coming, and it absolutely destroyed the back end of the car.
Short day for Sterling. Jeff Green leads Casey Atwood, last year's runner-up in this race. Jason Keller, Joe Nemechek, and Todd Bodine to the green flag.
A little bit of a surprise that Joe Nemechek, we documented that he took on two tires way back when everybody took only four tires, so he had two more tires to take. He chose not to come in this time and take them.
Great look at the leaders as they go through the corner from Joe Nemechek's car. As we come off turn four, you can see Casey Atwood just inches away from Jeff Green as they go down in turn one. Nemechek looking all over the back of Wallace's car.
Casey Atwood could become the youngest winner in Busch Series history. Rob Moroso was 19 when he won at Myrtle Beach in 1988. Atwood is 18.
Atwood's dropping back just a little bit. Jason Keller's picked up his theme just a little bit in third place there. All over the back of Casey Atwood.
And there's a lap car, Kenny Wallace, between them and Nemechek, Todd Bodine, Jeff Purvis, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. are up there in sixth and seventh after having cars that didn't work that well earlier in the day. There's Earnhardt, and right behind him, Elton Sawyer, the number 2 point man, the number 3 point man in the series. After today, and there's 59 Mike Dillon battling 37 Kevin Grubb at age 20, another of the young drivers making their mark. At 77 Ed Barrier, another great Nashville Speedway champion. Jimmy Means is his crew chief, longtime Winston Cup driver. Means won a track title here, and then the next year was leading the points with four races to go, broke his car, and they canceled the next three races. Walter Wallace, now an NASCAR official, won the title. And Means said, enough of this, I'm going Winston Cup racing.
All right, you did that for many years, now very successfully guiding the efforts off the car number 77 off Ed Barrier, who won at Hickory last year.
Speaking of Ed Barrier, yeah, exactly. That was their first win ever. Ed Barrier had the longest non-winning streak. Jimmy Means turned the program around. They won at Hickory last year.
Ride with Stanton Barrett, our channel lock cam, just behind Elliott Sadler. Barrett is 19th, Sadler is 18th, one lap down. 15 cars are on the lead lap. Now, Matt Kenseth is at the tail end of the lead lap. He did make a pit stop to check that right front tire, and Kenseth's car, he may have bent the steering somehow when he got into Sterling Marlin, because he is running on pace, but in no position to move up and challenge.
Yeah, he hit the inside wall as well as hitting Sterling Marlin, so that could have done the damage too if the front end set him.
Fourth, fifth, and sixth place, Nemechek 87 and fourth, Todd Bodine in fifth, and here comes Jeff Purvis in that number four as you look back from Nemechek. First time he ever raced at this racetrack, Jeff Purvis failed to qualify for the All-American 400. The next year he came back and won it, and he won it twice more.
Exactly, he's right on pace too right now, and he's all over the back of Todd Bodine. As we look back from Nemechek, you can see Todd Bodine in 66 there, really moving in. Purvis there in the four, Earnhardt just behind them.
That's fourth through seventh place in that battle. And then Elton Sawyer, he's on the lead lap. Haven't seen much of that 98 car today, but Sawyer's having a good, strong run here. And has a chance, especially if Kenseth has misfortune. He could be the point leader when we leave today. Fourth, there's fifth, Todd Bodine, 66. Sixth, the four of Jeff Purvis. Keeping close tabs on each other. As the laps wind down here in Nashville, there is Elton Sawyer, 98, right behind the three of Earnhardt Jr. and Phil Parsons, the ninth place, car number 10.
Elton Sawyer in the 98 there has been one of the most consistent drivers on the circuit this year. That team is really coming together. As you see, Phil Parsons having to check up there or get in the left rear of Sawyer, getting down into turn one.
Sawyer, runner-up at Darlington. And here's your leader once again. This is Jeff Green, second at Daytona, third at Texas. You see some highlights. Casey Atwood turned over at Daytona, but he got a fifth at Rockingham the next week. He finished second here last year. He's in second right now. Jason Keller, sixth place at Texas last week, his best finish of the young season.
Having a good run here today.
At 61 is laps down. Roper is 47 laps back, and Kenny Wallace with 25. Also several laps down.
Joe Nemechek, 87 there. Todd Bodine in the 66.
Todd had a fifth at Atlanta, his best run to date this year. And Jeff Purvis looking for his first top 10 finish this year in the four.
Three, Dale Earnhardt Jr., of course, moving in there. Elton Sawyer, 98.
Yeah, Sawyer had a second at Darlington, seventh at Rockingham, eighth at Atlanta. Phil Parsons, third at Darlington, his best of the year.
Good qualifying effort here, currently running ninth.
Now that 37.
Kevin Grubb, he's several laps down.
Four laps down, Ned.
Mike McLaughlin, 34 car.
10th place car. And the 59 of Dillon is one lap down. He's racing against the 47 of Sadler, also one lap down.
Both those cars went a lap down early, and there's Ed Barrier in the car number 77. He's being shown two laps down in 23rd position.
Joe Buford, 67 there.
Nashville local Speedway, talent. Yep, Speedway champ in 18th place, one lap back. And the 40 of Stanton Barrett, one position behind Buford. 23 laps to go as we wind down the Nashville 320 after this message and a word from your local station.
If you've never experienced the thrill of Mach 3, it's wake-up time. Introducing Mach 3 from Gillette, the first triple-blade shaving system. Three blades positioned to shave progressively closer. You take one stroke, it takes three, so you don't have to shave over and over, which means less irritation. Three blades, fewer strokes, less irritation. Mach 3 from Gillette.
Doug Flutie and Olympic gold medalist Tommy Moe lead the stars into battle as they run, bike, shoot, and swim their way to victory. The Snapple Superstars on CBS.
The address is CBS.
Welcome home!
The Greenville Growl needs your support for the last home game of the regular season. This Saturday, it's Fan Appreciation Night, when the Growl takes on arch rival, the PD Pride. Plus, the first 2,500 people to donate $1 to Center Ice Charities will receive a special Easter egg. Tickets on sale at the Bilo Center box office and all ETM ticket outlets. So don't miss the action when the Growl puts the bite on the PD Pride. Saturday night at 7:30 at the Bilo Center in Greenville. Be there.
On Hollywood Squares, laugh with Roseanne until it hurts.
What did Peter Gabriel say you should do to the monkey in his 1982 hit?
He said you should spank it.
With big-time stars and comedy you can count on.
Where do men spend an average of 81 minutes a day?
Driving their tools. Cars.
Don't miss Roseanne, Thomas Gibson, Debbie Reynolds, and RuPaul on Hollywood Squares, nominated for 5 Daytime Emmys.
Monday at 7 on News Channel 7. Futurecast, only on News Channel 7.
CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 is sponsored by Gateway. Let's talk about your Gateway. Super 8 Motel. And by Lawn Boy, making mowing easier.
Welcome back to Nashville. We're watching this great battle for fourth place. Todd Bodine at 66 trying to take it away from Joe Nemechek.
Mike, that's fourth through 10th. Every one of those cars are still in this. What a great race they're having back there. You see Todd Bodine looking on the inside of Nemechek. Purvis there in the four. He's been checking them out, but cannot get a racetrack smooth enough to make the move and pass both the cars. I think he may be quicker, but he just can't make the move.
And in the midst of that pack are two cars, either of whom could be the point leader after today. Elton Sawyer may leave here with a point lead, but if Mike McLaughlin, if one more car is overpassed there, it could be Mike McLaughlin with the point lead.
You can see the telemetry there as Nemechek goes down the straightaway, down the front stretch here, still turning very close to 8,000, about 130 miles an hour.
The speeds have been, speed and RPMs have been pretty constant all afternoon.
You can't see, but what Joe sees in that rearview mirror is everybody. Todd Bodine is right there underneath him now, trying to pull alongside Jeff Purvis, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Elton Sawyer.
Now this is what short track racing is all about. You see Todd Bodine every once in a while trying that low side, does not get enough grip. Coming up out of the corner, Earnhardt, he's been trying high and low to get by Purvis.
Well, they've been out there about, 70 laps on this set of tires, and they're getting worn, and it's hard to get that traction down on the inside once those tires get heated up. But Todd, he keeps trying. Here he comes again. Stick that nose under there. Not going to work.
Right behind them, Elton Sawyer and Mike McLaughlin have gotten past Dale Earnhardt Jr. Let's go to pit road.
Bobby Hill just bounced off the wall right in front of us on pit road, Mike. On that last lap, he's running slowly around the backstretch. Meanwhile, Jeff Green's radio between he and his crew has absolutely been crackling. They're trying to make sure he doesn't run any too fast, doesn't wear that car out, but they know they've got the car to beat, and it's looking really good. And Green just a moment ago keyed the radio and said, victory lane, and it came back to him, us, yes. Let's go to Ralph.
For what could be the two-point leaders, side-by-side, 98 Sawyer and 34 McLaughlin, side-by-side in the corner. One of them could leave here with a point lead.
Elton Sawyer in the 98 there, getting great grip up out of the corner. Rockets down the back straightaway. He might be the quickest car right now on the racetrack, but he cannot get racing room.
McLaughlin's going to have to give him some on the high side. Whoa, that was Purvis. Number four, Purvis, out of shape.
He was out of shape coming off of turn four. Gathers it back in. He has nowhere to go, really, even if his car was fast enough, as those cars continue to race side by side behind him, but they're racing side by side for a moment in front of him.
And that was 66 Todd Bodine out of shape coming off the corner, trying to stay underneath Joe Nemechek.
Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. lost about three positions just a little while ago. He got loose getting in the corner and dropped back quite a bit. You see right now he's got a mirror full of Parsons right there as they start down the back straightaway.
Fourth is Nemechek, fifth, the 66 of Bodine. You could throw all five of them under a blanket here for fifth place.
Don't have to go too far back to 10th place.
You don't have to go far at all, Ned, only five more laps. Jeff Green, kind of forgot about him because he's kind of by himself.
And Casey Atwood, you can see, was about 15 car lengths back, so Jeff Green right now is his race to lose. He does not want to make a mistake. Casey Atwood, another great run.
Something big could happen here, though, for fourth place.
Jeff Green has a 1.4-second lead, but this battle is
very, very good. Nemechek, Bodine in fifth, Purvis in sixth, McLaughlin, Sawyer, Earnhardt, Parsons. Casey Atwood just slid way up the racetrack and gathered it back in. He's got some room on Jason Keller, so that won't hurt him. And here's Jeff Green, our leader. All of this action's going to happen behind him.
Mike, is it going to tighten up back here? These guys are starting to make a little contact on each other. Each spot here means a lot. You see McLaughlin right there under Purvis.
Two to go for them. Jeff Green's about two-thirds of a lap in front of that pack, and here he comes around for the white flag. Looking for his second Busch Series triumph. Atwood in second. Alone in third is Keller. Big battle for fourth. That fourth-place battle just took the white flag. Owensboro, Kentucky. Jeff Green, youngest of those three racing brothers, is going to get his second Busch Series win. Checkered flag on Green. Atwood is second. Keller will be third. Here's the race for fourth. Bodine tried it, couldn't get it. McLaughlin could not get Purvis. They crossed the line just the way they did the last 20 times around. Wow.
Chemistry. He says he's happier right now than he's ever been in a race car. This team has really gelled.
They have really come together. They have. New team this year, and just he's doing a great job of driving. They gave him a great race car.
Well, Ned, I was wrong at the top of the show. I said at the end of the day the only car without a mark on it would be the pace car, but I don't see where Jeff Green has gotten into any of these scrapes all day.
Well, you know, Sterling said that they got together just a little bit, but it's hard to see the marks on the side of that race car.
Yep. J. Jeff Green does a great job. It's a homecoming for him, former track champ here.
The only thing he needs Kleenex for today, wiping that dust off his face.
Or tears
no
of joy.
No crying.
That's right. What a wild finish for fourth place. And Jeff Green will advance from 10th to 5th in the Busch Series points. We'll be back to talk to the winner here at Nashville Speedway after this.
Today we're going to learn the easy way to mow the lawn. This is a lawn. This is a boy. Lawn. Boy. Lawn. Boy. Lawn boy. Easy, huh?
Lawn boy. Easy to start, easy to use, easy to maintain.
Any questions?
Why are there two of you?
NASCAR driver Jeff Burton goes head-to-head with everyday driver Eileen.
My car has a 750-horsepower high-compression engine.
My car has an engine.
I can cruise all afternoon at 180 miles per hour.
I'll stick to 55, thanks.
I start my engine with a powerful XI NASCAR Select battery.
Me too. Thanks.
The XI NASCAR Select battery. It's not just for race cars.
Uh-oh. I'm a junior VP, and all the junior VPs have one of these. So I'll just call my secretary, and then she'll... voicemail. Chuck number 4 is down.
Gotcha.
I'm a mailroom guy, and all the mailroom guys get to see the phones that the senior VPs get.
Nextel's two-way radio feature makes ordinary cell phones seem ordinary.
If you're the kind of person who'd rather tune an engine than eat, who reads a tachometer like a love story, for whom the roar of fully blown horsepower is a lullaby, have we got a machine for you? And in the hands of the right mechanic, it'll blow the doors off anything. Aim high, Air Force.
Monday on The Late Show, country super trio Willie Nelson, Lyle Lovett, and Kris Kristofferson, plus Charles Grodin. Later this week, Drew Barrymore and boxer Lennox Lewis.
Jeff Green dueled with Sterling Marlin most of the day and then held off the field to win his second Busch Series race at his home track in Nashville. Dick Berggren's in victory lane.
It is a very happy place to be here. Jeff Green, all the experience you have had here at Nashville, how important was that in your victory today?
Well, I don't know. These guys pick up on it pretty good. My experience with these guys helping me, Harold Holly and all the guys, they put an excellent race car under me, and I could just stab on it. I every lap, I wanted to. Sterling had a good car, but we was a class field today, thanks to Kleenex, Scott Brand, Kroger, and everybody that helped us. Fisher Horsepower, man, that thing run good all day. And we just got an awesome race team. I think a lot of people took us lightly, but they don't take us lightly now, Dick.
Have you got the right team? You struggled in this division. A lot of people thought you had the right team when you drove for Dale Earnhardt, but it's the mix right now.
You've seen what it did today. And it's been doing that every week. We just fell short of a couple wins here. And we capitalized on today and come home in Nashville. Finally got that guitar from Barb Hummer, and I'm going to go play it.
Did you watch the Sterling Marlin wreck in your rearview mirror?
Well, somebody radioed said he had a cut left flat tire, and I just got up on the inside of him. It's all... I could just get by him then, and they said he spun out. I hate it for him, but he had a great car. I love racing with those Winston Cup guys. I love beating them, so I wished he'd been there then, but I ain't gonna lose no sleep over not being there too.
Did you guys touch in that incident?
I don't know. I was trying to get up under him, you know, like just like he was doing me, and he was running where I needed to be, and it was just gonna be a good race. It was probably gonna be a little tighter than we really wanted it to be, but my car, man, this Kleenex Chevrolet Monte Carlo was awesome today. And next week's Bristol. That's my favorite track. We're going there next.
So many drivers do well here at Nashville, then get on to the big league. What is there about this racetrack that breeds stars?
It's slick, and it's abrasive, man. You got to take care of your car to be there at the end. And I just tell those guys, just tell me how many laps to go when I was behind Sterling, so I could just save my tires and have something there at the end. And it worked out good for us. You know, Harold's dad's been sick, so we wish him well. And I had a friend killed a couple nights ago. In Charlotte, I want to say my blessings for that family, and we're simply with them, you know, and we want to wish our prayers for that family. It's a tough situation.
Indeed. Uncle Bob Harmon, the guitar, your 50th anniversary as a racetrack promoter. Question is, could Jeff Green play this thing? You know how to play this, Jeff?
I don't know how to play it, but I promise it's going to look good on my shelf, and we'll pick a tune every once in a while.
All right. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, we're here with Casey Atwood, and a big contingent of local fans around you here today, Casey. And 2 years in a row, you've made some pretty spectacular drives at this racetrack. Tell me about today's effort.
I'll tell you what, this was a lot harder than last year. You know, had to come from the back, and I think we had the fastest car on the track at one time. And we was real good on real long runs, like over 50-lap runs. And after everybody's tires wore out, and we just didn't have enough time right there at the end. Jeff was real strong. I picked him to win the race when we came down here. He's won a lot of late model championships here, and just come up a little short. But I got to thank Castro and Bruco Motorsports, Mountain Dew. The crew done a great job. I mean, we struggled big time yesterday in practice, and to come back and finish second, we feel real lucky to be here.
Obviously, tire management was a big part of you having good long runs. How did you save your tires today?
I didn't. I ran as hard as I could every lap. Had to come from the back.
Well, now, how do you save tires if you got to run that hard?
At the beginning of that last run, I was kind of trying to save them, but so I could get them on the longer run. But pretty much, I was all out all day coming from the back.
Mike, it worked.
He started 26th and finished second. It's a long-standing tradition here at Nashville that the winner gets a Les Paul Gibson guitar.
Only appropriate here in Music City, USA.
And we'll be right back.
Have one.
Sponsor the NASCAR Busch Series.
As NAPA drivers, you're responsible for safely delivering the best parts in the world. So I've brought in a special guest instructor, Ron Hornaday, NASCAR Truck Series champion.
You want to go to the turns about 130.
What's a safe distance to be from the guy in front of you?
5 inches. It's called drafting.
Huh?
All right, get in the truck. I'm going to have to show you. You getting all this down?
Final hole of the final round, and my second shot was on the green. Fred Couples played his third from the bunker. Now I was just a putt away. I thought, this is what it's all about. Now it was in my hands.
Mark O'Meara has won the Masters.
The greatest day of my career. 18 years to win a major, and it came here in Augusta. A tradition unlike any other, the Masters on CBS.
CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 is sponsored by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right.
Welcome back to Nashville. Hope you've enjoyed the beat and bang of short track racing. This fellow, Jeff Green, certainly did. 13 drivers finished on the lead lap today. Green the winner, Casey Atwood for the second year in a row finishes second. Best run of the season for Jason Keller, third, and Joe Nemechek winds up fourth. Fifth is Todd Bodine. Jeff Purvis came from the back to finish sixth. Mike McLaughlin will likely be the point standing leader. He or Elton Sawyer, who finished seventh and eighth today. Phil Parsons shown in the ninth spot. Buckshot Jones, Tony Raines, Adam Petty. They all finished on the lead lap. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Bobby Hillen, Matt Kenseth, whose car faded after running into Sterling Marlin. Joe Buford, the track champ, Mike Dillon, Stanton Barrett, Jeff Fuller, rounding out the top 20. Look further down in the field, all of these cars were two or more laps behind at the finish.
There was hard racing going on all through the pack on drivers that were, even though they were laps down.
Sterling Marlin led most of the race today, 34th.
Led 145 laps, but ended up in the garage, and all of these drivers were also out of the race before the finish. Let's go to Dick Berger.
With Jason Keller, who came down to congratulate the winner, Jeff Green. And I'm looking at your driving suit. Look at this. He's got a dog tag on the zipper. It says, Jason, if found, returned to dog pound. What is that all about?
Guys call themselves the dog pound because we're kind of underdogs. You know, nobody saw us all day long and snuck up there in third and
Teammate won, we finished third. It's a great day, you know. Had great pit stops all day long and kept me up front. Fought the car a little bit, made a lot of changes this morning, which was a lot better. And my wife, she kind of got on to this morning. She wasn't here, but hi to everybody back home, Dev, Joe, and Jade, and be home tonight. But what a great day, you know. Fleming Team IGA, Kellogg's, Coca-Cola, Nabisco, Kraft, everybody that supported Farb. You know, kind of been behind the eight ball, and Progressive Motorsports has won three today. And before long, people are going to really take notice of us and know who we are.
Tell us about the race car. How badly beaten up was it at the end of this thing?
Well, in the middle of the race, we changed it a little bit, and really didn't help it. So there at the end, we went back, and it was the best it'd been all day long. Just a little tight all day, and we're a little bit tight yesterday, but, you know, it's a great day. We didn't get so beat up that we couldn't race with them there at the end, and we had to use a Horner time or two coming through the pack, but, you know, I really thought if I could hang in there on the big tracks there at the beginning of the year, once I got the short tracks, that I'd be pretty good, and, man, what a day.
Well, congratulations to you. Terrell Shaheen.
Well, Dick, there's a little conversation going on down here between fourth-place finisher Joe Nemechek and fifth-place finisher Todd Bodine. You know, that great battle they had at the end? Well, Joe's supposed to give Todd a ride home in Joe's plane, and you said if what?
I said if he spins me out, he's going to be thumbing it on the way home. So.
Tell me about that battle on the last lap. What happened?
What a day here at the Bellsouth Mobility 320. It was a good battle. My car would run high. We took on two tires at the end, and I had to run high. My car was just no good down at the bottom, and I knew Todd had to pass me on the bottom, and he was getting really loose doing it, so it was up to him to pass me.
Well, I saw as your car rolled by, you guys were taking a look at all the battle scars and deciding who put which scars in which car, and how did you do? Did you come out in ahead or behind him on the scar leaving mark?
Well, I think we're pretty even on that one, yeah. We got underneath Joe going into one, and we just got together a little bit, just good hard racing, you know. But other than that, we raced clean there, and we had a good run. The Prop Arter car, Phillips 66 crew, did a great job. It's a brand new car. Bring it out with no testing on it and run good. Like Joe said, I was just a little too loose. I'd push in the middle and get loose off, and I just couldn't get by him. But we had a heck of a race. I hope the fans enjoyed the show.
First short track, we go to Bristol next now. What did you learn here today as you get ready for the short track season?
I better get in better shape. It's tough. It's a little humid. This is the hottest it's been for us racing. You notice it. It takes a little toll as the race goes on, but I can't wait to get to Bristol. I've always run well there. I've got three wins, and just looking forward to going back.
I don't suppose since he bumped you as much as he did, I could hitch his ride to Charlotte.
Oh, if you need a ride, we might be able to take care of it.
All right, Mike.
Okay, Ralph. Great run for both those drivers and a great battle right down to the checkered flag. It's unpredictable here in Nashville. Jeff Green's the eighth different winner in the eight runnings of this race. We'll be right back.
Life in the Outback isn't all fun and games. After all, sometimes we have to eat.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Outback Steakhouse, no rules, just right.
Older eaters' feet are sweeter, fresher, drier, cleaner, neater. Just kick off your shoe, and you'll know it's true.
Only Odor Eaters insoles, sprays, and powders are fortified with genuine Arm & Hammer baking soda. They destroy, devour, and defend against foot odor and wetness.
Odor Eaters feed us sweeter.
1-877-780-RACE proudly presents official NASCAR merchandise.
Hi, everyone. I'm Brian Collard. While you're watching live coverage of the Bellsouth Mobility 320 here on CBS, we've got something special for die-cast fans, the brand-new innovation of 118 die-cast scale cars. This is the Dale Earnhardt Jr. under the hood, around the car, the side skirt for super speedways, and available on top the roof laps on each car. Jeff Gordon available as well in the Rainbow Warrior number 24. A look inside the straps, the fire extinguisher, the cord, and Dale Earnhardt part of the grouping. And how about the M&M's car of Ernie Irvin? A look from underneath the car all the way up. Steve Parkin here, the Wrangler car, and Dale Jarrett, Rusty Wallace, part of the group as well. Each car available at only $79.85. The amazing innovation of 118 die-cast scale metal cars. Call us at that toll-free number and ask about other great merchandise and the upcoming Sterling Marlin Tennessee Volunteer car as we take you back live to CBS Sports coverage at the Nashville Motor Speedway.
An American stealth fighter goes down behind enemy lines. Guess whose job it is to get it back?
We are here to recover our plane.
JAG, CBS Tuesday.
Tonight on CBS, America's Night of Heroes begins with an all-new early edition. Then it's a wild night at the opera for martial arts superstar Sammo Hung on martial law, followed by an all-new Sons of Thunder. America's Night of Heroes is tonight on CBS. A jubilant scene in victory lane for Jeff Green, picking up his second series win. And here's a look at the point standings. Mike McLaughlin came out of that battle with Elton Sawyer, 5 points ahead in the standings. Matt Kenseth is just 1 point behind them. Then Dale Earnhardt Jr., Jeff Green climbs to fifth, and Jason Keller moves up to sixth. Then Jeff Burton and Mark Martin, who were not here today, Todd Bodine seventh, Randy LaJoy, Phil Parsons, and Kevin LePage, the top dozen in the series standings. Let's go to Dick Berggren.
And I'm with young 10-year-old Thomas Purvis, whose dad, Jeff, finished in sixth spot today. Best run of the day. Did your dad do okay?
Yes, sir.
Did you see him make any mistakes at all out there, or was he perfect all day?
I don't know.
Well, how about it, Jeff? Did you make any mistakes, or was it a good day for you all around?
No, I'm sure I made some mistakes along the way, but, you know, we were just a little bit loose all day. I knew the car was going to be pretty good last night in the last practice, but, you know, I thought that the track was going to be a little bit tighter than it was, and I just couldn't get off the corners. And, you know, we've had some good runs right here with this Lance team this year. We just hadn't had any good finishes.
And you've had some good runs here at Nashville. A bit sad about this racetrack going away and a big one being built.
Well, it is in a way, but, you know, that's what brings the fans, and that's what makes this race, the Busch race, and pay more money. So, you know, I'm ready for them to bring it on. Let's see how we do there.
That was totally sold out today, and a lot of people couldn't get in to see it that wanted to. Terrell Shaheen.
Well, Matt Kenseth had a busy day. Your car was extremely loose, and you ended up taking 5 rounds of wedge. Tell me about that.
Well, we had to throw something at it. It wasn't very fast the way it was, but Robbie and the whole team did really, really good for me this week. We didn't have a very fast car at all in the beginning. We kept working on it and trying different combinations and made some big changes on the car. And actually, that last combination was pretty good. And they get a really good pit stop, got me in front of everybody, got me out, I think, second or third. And I think we would have run third. We weren't good enough to beat Jeff or Sterling, but then Sterling just got flat tired on there and I have nowhere to go.
Tell me about that. What took place in that?
Well, Jeff passed Sterling getting in the three there, and you know, they didn't hit or anything, it didn't look like. And then Sterling followed him in there, and I was about 3 car lengths behind him, and he just went in and spun out like he had a flat left rear. So he started going up the racetrack, and I tried to stop because I knew when he went up he was going to come back down, but I couldn't go high, and you know, I went to the bottom, and he just came down there and closed the gap with inside wall there.
Mike.
Thanks, Ralph. Good run for Matt Kenseth today, and we'll be back with more from Nashville Fairgrounds right after this word.
Whoa!
Weeds, huh, Pete?
Yeah.
Try Ortho Weed Be Gone.
Weed Be what?
Gone, as in out of here.
Like adios.
Weed Be Gone kills weeds without harming your lawn.
Didn't hurt my lawn.
Ortho guarantees it.
Now that's a great lawn.
Lawn weeds? Leave it to Ortho.
Used to be, if I want something done right, I called me. It worked. Until I tried to quit smoking. I needed more than me. I got Nicorette. Nicorette helped me two ways. I used it on a regular schedule to help prevent my cravings. And for unexpected cravings, I was ready with an extra piece. I used to be a slave to cigarettes. Nicorette helped me hang on, helped me win. Now that I'm nicotine free, I gotta tell you, it feels good to win.
Now Nicorette is available in mint. What a refreshing choice. You can do it. Nicorette can help.
All across America, we're there to see you through.
Racing is hard on cars. Always has been. So is everyday city driving. Jiffy Lube makes it easy to take care of your car, and they offer Pennzoil. Just drive in. Drive out. Drive on.
We're more than just a matter of changing neighbor Jiffy Lou. Drive in, drive out, drive on.
All right, listen up. Coach's plane is stuck in Idaho. But since it's our first bowl game...
Coach? All right. Get in there and hit somebody now. Go! No. Somebody got him. They didn't come to play today. First
down. Presenting video conferencing.
Do I have to go in there and do it for you?
Because sometimes it's not just what you say, but how you say it. Kinko's, express yourself.
Join CBS as NASCAR rocks with the Allman Brothers and today's hottest performers for a kickin' coast-to-coast tour. A summer smash with NASCAR rocks. CBS Sports coverage of the Nashville 320 is sponsored by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right. Nicorette gum. You can do it. Nicorette can help. And by Odor Eater's Foot Powder. Now destroys odor with baking soda.
Welcome back to Nashville. Let's join Dick Bergeron down in the garage.
With Dale Earnhardt Jr., that car was kind of a handful, but you still pulled the top 10 out. How'd you do that?
We qualified, you know, real well, and then we missed a setup in the race. The car didn't practice too good. We just kind of threw something in it this morning, and, man, was it a handful to ever begin with, and we went straight to the back. But we tried to work on a little bit and had it running pretty good at times, but never really had anything for any of those guys up front. And I want to congratulate Jeff Green. He done a great job, and it was just fun. You know, had a good time racing some of those guys, but it's difficult to pass, and the car was just sliding around like it was. We weren't going to go too far, but we're pretty happy. We're still considering ourselves a contender for the points this year, and AC Delco Chevrolet is going to be on top for us over with.
Still looking for that first win, though. Is this season turning out to be tougher for you than last?
Well, I don't know. You know, it's all in what you, you know, it's all, you make it what it is, and we've made some bad decisions, and it's haunted us, and so here, you know, like today, we made some bad decisions on the car this morning, and we got bit. What can I say? So hopefully we'll come around and win some races and turn this thing around a little bit.
He will win some races, and today did a good job bringing it home in one piece. Mike?
I think you're right, Dick. There will be racing next year here at the Nashville Fairgrounds. This track has been here for many years. It's not going anywhere. A new track is scheduled to be built outside of Nashville. But Ned, I don't expect that this would be the last Busch race here.
It very well might not be. Of course, a lot of people are assuming that if the new track is built, and I understand that they really haven't moved any dirt yet, it's been in the planning stage for a long time, that it would automatically move over to that track. And that's not always the case.
No.
Because NASCAR, of course, controls all of the races.
But both tracks, the new track that's proposed outside the city and this speedway, are run by the same management. This track seats about 16,000-17,000 folks, and the new track would be a super speedway. The winner here gets a guitar. Buddy, you've got one of those guitars.
I got one because I drove for a great man, Harry Hyde, and he said, if you'll listen to me, I'll help you win the race, and he did just that. He's going in the International Hall of Fame in Talladega. I'm going to induct him next month, so I'm looking forward to that.
1973 was that big victory, and what did you tell me when I asked you if you could play that guitar?
Pig with the wristwatch. That's what I was. I have no ability to play the guitar, but I was proud to get it.
But he can sing.
Yes, we know. Not today, folks. Well, Ned, we promised slam bang short track action. I think we got our money's worth.
I think we did, too. And I think the fans that were here today and hopefully those on watching television here today got their money's worth, too, because it was just what we thought it would be.
Well, a few bent fenders, a little bit of pride damaged, but a very popular win for Jeff Green and again Casey Atwood. These kids are taking the thing over.
They're coming, no doubt about it. And it's good to see.
Hope you folks have enjoyed it, too. For Buddy Baker, Ned Jarrett, Dick Bergeron, and Ralph Shaheen, I'm Mike Joy saying so long from Nashville, where Jeff Green has won the Nashville 320. Coming up next, CBS Sports Spectacular, the Chevy S10 Snowboard Grand Prix, followed by the Snapple.